Hello there, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome along to round 8 of the 2015 Super Cup season here at GPBWC. We're almost at the halfway point, and what a season we have had so far. It's been dominated by Walk Racing, it's been dominated by Ruud Heesterbeek, but nevertheless, we still had the fantastic battling that we had last year in 2014, and with the close times during qualifying, this 15-minute session so far, looking as close as ever, we are hopefully going to have just as good racing here tonight. My name is James Kirk. On our cameras once again is Mr. Mike Phyllis, and joining me in the co-commentary box, or just as a co-commentator, it's the commentary box, whatever, is Mr. Sam Jones. Away from the cameras, back on co-coms for today. I'm sure that you're going to be relieved about that, but looking at this qualifying session now, it seems to be a pretty common sight nowadays, isn't it? Two Walk Racings up the top, though this time it's Capit ahead of Heesterbeek, which is perhaps a little bit of a reverse of the norm.
Yeah, good evening, James. Good evening, everyone at home. And yeah, it's great to be back talking once again instead of pressing buttons. It's always more exciting. But yeah, at Silverstone, what a fantastic track. Always produces exciting racing. I had a lot of fun yesterday. And yep, we've got about 9 minutes left to go in qualifying. And Walk Racing 1-2. It's really been something that's kind of evolved over the season. They started off a bit slow, and people were saying, you know, maybe Walk Racing haven't got it right, because there was claims that they were going to have the best two drivers in the field and they were going to be the team to beat, and it didn't look that way at first, but now it certainly is starting to become the case, at least in one of the two races, because of course Super Cup is such a hard series to be able to take a double victory on any given race day. It is very difficult to do, but the Walk guys are doing a fantastic job. 1 and 2 very, very close in the timesheets, and it looks like some of the others have got some work to do in the last remaining 8 minutes.
So I'll go through our top 10 so far. It's Risto Capit on pole ahead of Ruud Heesterbeek. Now, Risto has taken a pole position before this season at the Portuguese round, and he did manage to convert that into a win. In fact, he hasn't taken a win this year, Risto, so to get another pole position would be a nice little accolade. Behind him is championship leader Ruud Heesterbeek, having such a great season, Ruud, but to be fair, that was half expected. As you say, a small blip at the start in Melbourne, double retirement. That seems a long time behind him. Now, Adrian McNaughton for Storm Racing Team, currently P3 in the times. That is an extraordinary effort for the Englishman, with then Svendorf second in the championship, P4 behind. Now, Manuel Grosjean, who has been on a great string of form so far, is in P5. Going into this round, he was set to have a podium streak to continue of 4 races in a row, but unfortunately he went over the track limit a bit too much in Canada, and a time penalty saw him set back to P6, so he got a P2, he's rolling on from that. Nevertheless, it's still a wonderful vein of form. He's not been out of the top 10 since the first round in he's not been out of the top 10 since Bahrain, so second round of the season there. Then you've got the two Wouters of Francis and Sandeep Chhoda filling in for David Yount, and Chhoda showing his stuff in Silverstone last time out in Formula Challenge yesterday. Got a podium as well. So looking good there. Philip Cullen P8 currently. Pedro Mel in P9, rounding out the top 10 is the new driver for Twitch Enterprise GP, Rate Tulikis, and what they would like to have in the form of points. They've not scored in 4, and he's just been knocked out the top 10 by Jonathan Holmes. There we go, his teammate Jonathan Holmes up into 6. He's not been on a good streak either, 3 races without scoring. But also a big one I want to point out is we welcome back Bence Zupanek. Now, Bence took part only briefly in the Spanish round for Motorforce, but he's here today with ST Racing, and not going to lie to you, they've had a torrid season, not being able to field good enough drivers to be able to score points, and there he is in P13 currently. Could the Hungarians score their first points of the year?
That's the question, and this guy has been very, very fast in Formula Challenge this year. Of course, that has been a series that's mainly been about one man, and that's Erik Strahm. But Zupanek's certainly been there. I think he's got a race win. I seem to remember he did.
It's hard.
It's hard to remember when you're usually about half a lap or more behind the leader.
Everyone, sigh of relief. You don't practice, Sam. Which is half the issue. You could be closer.
At one point I was in the points yesterday.
Whoa.
I did admittedly jump the start. I got a bit of a itchy finger. Jumped the start. dropped back a bit, and yeah, had some great battles there. That's what I love about this track. It's such a good track for battling on. It's so much fun. But yeah, back to the qualifying. I'm actually surprised. Well, I'm surprised by one thing, that Adrian McNaughton's doing so well at the moment, and Gixxella. Oh, look at that! Jonathan Holmes just jumps up to third. Now I'm surprised Gixxella's not there battling away with the Walk Racing, because he's been the real dark horse of qualifying this season.
Not at the starts though. His starts have been a bit poor so far, haven't they? And by the way, Ben Supernick with two Formula Challenge wins this year, and that was one in Canada Race 2 and one in Spain Race 2. So obviously want to capitalise on race twos as they are. We've got just under 5 minutes left. Your top ten now. Capit, who has extended his lead to 1/10 ahead of Ruud Heesebeek. These times are the quickest times we've seen on the server all 2 weeks long of practice. A 35.4 pretty much for Capit. So actually he's only about half a tenth ahead of Heesebeek. Holmes then P3, McNaughton 4th, De Vries 5th, Gixxella 6th, with Mellem 7th, Frančić 8th, Chona 9th, and Cullen rounding out the top 10 as Zupanek's now up to 11th, Tulikas 12th. Klont, once again, really neither here nor there in qualifying, struggling outside the top 10. Rauter P14, and David Tapa currently occupying the last point scoring position in a race, P15, and Tapa had a wonderful round last time, didn't he? P5 in race 2 after Gixxella's penalty, P6 in race 2, launching Street Fighter back into contention in the lower team's point, or in the lower team's battle. He'll want to get a little bit of a better form than P15, I'm sure, but points are points, and I'm sure that he will not be complaining. Anyway, as I see, Risto Kappa going out for a final run. I think Ruud Heesebeek is going to be going out for a final run soon as well. Can anyone match these two? We certainly haven't seen it on the server, as I said.
No, it's certainly not the case. I was just wondering, what's happened with Jason Muscat? Why is he so far down in 24th?
Right, Muscat is injured. He has recently had surgery on an area which no man would like to have surgery on, and he's debated about driving today, and I do wonder whether that was the best decision for him and his team. As you say, currently residing down in P24 and being threatened to be outqualified by his teammate Terence Grech for the first time this year. So sticking out is Jason, but given that the only man who is below him is Mark Fuller, it's not really looking that good for Motorforce, a team who fell down the championship last time out because of poor results. They're now down in 6th, so it's not looking good, too good for them, is it?
No, certainly not. I think Muscat's certainly feeling it right now. He's not actually even out. He's only put in 3 laps, an out lap and 2 timed laps, and I think clearly he's just not returned to the pits correctly, so he can't go out anyway from now on. Maybe he doesn't want to either. Maybe it's perhaps too uncomfortable for him, so he's going to have a lot of work to do during the race, and you know, we might not see him score any points today, which is going to be a bit of a disaster for the team. But it's certainly not a disaster for Walk Racing and Storm Racing as well. Both of these teams are really representing today in qualifying. At least it's great to see from both of them. And Twitch aren't doing too bad either, especially with their new driver in 12th and Jonathan Holmes in 3rd.
Got to break a curse, Twitch. They have not scored with the second car in any race so far this season, so maybe today's the day. But as you rightly say, Gixxella now moving up to join his teammate there. It's looking a bit Noah's Ark, apart from poor old Holmes on his own there in 3rd. But McNaughton still out-qualifying Gixxella. That's a big story for me, because McNaughton has very much been second fiddle to Gixxella so far this season. It would be nice to see him getting some good points and maybe even challenge for a podium. Could happen. De Vries still 6th then, with Cullen P7, but looks like he is done and dusted for qualifying the Irishman. Sandy Choda up to 8th, Mellem 9th, and now it's Frančić rounding out the top 10. So Wout is looking good as well. Interesting news story about Simcroft though, broke very recently. Tom van der Voort, a man who has scored, let's have a look here, 1, 2, 3 race victories this season so far, has moved up permanently to Midnight Motorsport in the Super League. So Simcroft only with one driver here today. Given that they are second in the championship, surely that is going to put a huge dent on their aspirations to even... Oh, sorry, they're third in the championship, but surely it's going to put a huge dent in their championship charge anyway, perhaps leaving them a bit open to the likes of Wouters and Storm behind.
Yeah, of course, it's been deja vu for them, really, because they lost Tom Parker earlier on in the season for the same reason. So, it's disappointing for the team, because Simcraft have been such a good team in Super Cup for the last couple of years. Oh. And now, suddenly, they've got one driver. He's still good, though, Pedro Melem. Still a good guy, definitely a top 10 driver. And we'll see if he can improve coming around the final couple of corners now.
Rude he's to be, because just improved. He's within 4,000ths of his teammate Cap. It's still unable to capitalize. The timer has gone to zero, so this is all last lap. Lagoon, what a last lap Lagoon, I don't know what I'm talking about, but hey, Melim, we were talking about him possibly improving, and he has done, into P7 for the Simcraft driver, though perhaps not as good as expected. Who is that coming around the final corner? Not too sure, actually. McGlade there, sorry, McGlade into P11 for Racing Aces PB. He did very well as a Rate Tulakis then moves up into P11. Ben Zupanek finishes up in P13. McNaughton unable to improve. Holmes into the pits. So I think the only person who can beat Capit now potentially is Heesterbeek. I see Capit and Gashella coming in close tow. De Vries is gone. Milim, Cullen, Shoda and Franchich come around the final corners. Now let's go to Franchich, currently P9 and P10, the Wouters Automotive guys. Franchich crosses the line, improves but not enough. Same for Shoda, an improvement but not enough to move them out of P9 and P10. Capit into the pits. And Gashella into third. So Gashella has outqualified his teammate at 1:35.444 for the Romanian. But it wasn't good enough. For the second time this year, Risto Capit takes pole position. And he has become the second man only this year to be able to do that after Emmanuel Gashella. But he won't care a jot, because look at that behind him. Rude Heesterbeek, his teammate. He's there in P2 as well. So Walk Racing getting ever closer to that title by the looks of it.
Yeah, still got a long way to go though today, because they've got to get through the first lap all clean and tidy, and they're not going to take each other out, well, at least we hope not. But Gekshella's there, although he will inevitably have a poor start, unfortunately. But yeah, he was once again the only guy in the field that could really challenge the Walk guys in going into qualifying. So good effort by him. Holmes, he could get a good start. It's always hit and miss with him. And McNaughton, I think he's going to be a bit of a wild card.
Dark horse,
really.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't usually see him so high up the field. He'll come through the field during the race, usually race as well. So it'd be interesting to see what he could do today. I'm very much looking forward to it.
And let's have a look at other shout out. So De Vries perhaps a little bit disappointed with sixth, maybe same for Milim. Seventh, I think the bottom end of the top 10 will be quite happy with that. Cullen P8 and the two Wouters P9 and 10 keeping up some good form of late. Rate Tulakis on his debut, P11, he'll be happy with that. And Lewis McGlade as well, P12. He got two P13s last time out in Canada, did McGlade, so I'm pretty sure he'll be happy with that. And as will ST. Points potentially on the card thanks to Zupanek. He's got to keep it clean during the race though. Router P14 for Smile, and there's Menno Klont again languishing down in P15. And unfortunately, after such a great outing in Canada, Tapper down in P16 as well. I noticed that Ballant Hammer there is P20. He's going to start on the prime compound tyre, but he has got a 10 place grid penalty for Fox Racing, and so we'll start from the back. Only 26 drivers here today though, which is rather sad. We've got four cars missing. Actually, no, I lie.
25 starting. Yeah.
Yep, so five drivers missing. We know one of them's a Simcraft. I think we're missing... Let's see, what else are we missing? We're missing a Majuric. We're missing a Street Fighter. We are missing... I'm not too sure what else we're missing, actually. But either way, it's probably the smallest field we've seen today. It's usually been good attendance. It seems that Silverstone's been a time for little attendance this year, because we didn't have that many, or as many as usual, in the World Sports Series, and I think Formula Change was a bit of a blip on the radar, to be honest.
Yeah, I guess everyone was really keen. I actually had a teammate this week.
Nice, yeah.
Formula Change is great to see, and good effort by my teammate as well. So yeah, a bit of a lacking in terms of the field size. Of course, GPVWC do monitor their fields quite closely, and it is important to be able to field two drivers as much of the season as possible. And that's a good thing to see, because it's always a shame when you see a lot of sim racing series towards the end of the season. You often see, you know, kind of interest starts to wane and the field sizes decrease. But in GPVWC, that typically doesn't happen too much, which always means we get good field, good amount of racing throughout the field, and often gives a chance for some of the guys who maybe wouldn't usually get into the field to at least give it a go and have a chance in a higher formula towards the end of the year, and potentially look at moving up for the year after. So it's a nice little format that they have, and it keeps all the racing very, very good and entertaining, and I hope we continue to see a better field next time out.
Yeah, let's hope. Let's go through the drivers and team standings, shall we? So, top 10 in the drivers, led by Ruud Heesterbeek, ever tightening his grip on the championship. 236 points the Dutchman is on. He is about 50 points ahead now of Sven De Vries. Looking pretty ominous for the rest of the field. Jason Muscat, who qualified very poorly today, is on 164 points, 20 behind Sven. And Tom van der Voort, as I say, he's left the series. We can count him out, but he's on 150 points there. Manu Gachella rounding out the top five on 149. Capit, who could make a couple of gains today, on 133. Siggy, who has also left the championship, on 126. Then Klont on 101. Frantic on 101. And David Junt, who isn't here today either, rounding out the top 10, a good 20 points back from Frantic. So there's a real middle class starting to develop here in the top 10, between second and ninth. Ruud at the top, starting to stream away. Junt and the rest of the field behind in 10th, starting to fall away. In terms of the teams, Walk Racing, now almost 100 points ahead of Satellite. Walk on 369, Satellite on 285. Simcroft, with only one car here today, are then 40 points back from Satellite on 241. Wouters, because of Gachella's penalty, moved back up into 4th on 181, with Storm behind them in 5th on 177. Multiforce is P6 with 168. Positive, with only one... Actually, no, Positive. There's no cars here for Positive today. So there's where the other two cars are. So Positive, no show today on the 153, but they've got a mighty 70-point gap on Racing Aces PB, so they might be able to hold that for now. Zurich then in 9th on 82, Smile Power rounding out the top 10 on 74. Of course, the big story today might be ST scoring their first points of the season. We would certainly like that. So we've got 1 minute left for qualifying. We're just having our race directors brief everyone on the correct procedure on what's happening. If you're new with us, of course, it's about the halfway point, so you might as well retell the story. You start on the compound you qualify on. So if you qualified on options, the red marked tyre, then you start on them. Same case with the primes, the white marked tyre. Primes last longer, options don't. Options are faster, though. Should see some good strategy. Might see some two stops today as well. I think one stop will be the strategy that everyone tries to go for, but maybe a bit of tyre saving can work its way in. Then we have our feature race today. It's 30 laps. You've got to use both compounds of tyre in that race, so one pit stop is at least guaranteed. And then we have a 6 to 10 place reverse grid for race 2, which is a sprint format of 17 laps long here today. 8 seconds left. Sam, who are you putting your money on for the race win today?
Oh, I think, actually, to be fair to say, I think there's only one guy I can say. I think it's going to be Ruud Heesterbeek, because he's on such a roll right now. And yes, he may not have qualified on pole, but I have a feeling over a race distance, he'll make the move, get into the lead, and we could see a repeat of Canada and of course Monaco, where we had a walk racing 1-2 in race 1. I won't be surprised at all. So yeah, I'm going to go for Heesterbeek and Capit in that order.
I was going to think about being interesting, but I have to agree with you. I think Ruud is too experienced in GPVWC as a whole. You know, Capit's been on pole before, he hasn't converted it, and I'm just going to have a look at who won that race. It was actually Jason Muscat. So remember, it was that really rainy race at the Circuit Algarve, which the form book was thrown out the window, essentially, which Capit lost. I'm not sure whether he will even be allowed to keep hold of the lead, to be honest, because Ruud is very much looking to win that championship, and Capit has taken a bit of time to get into his form, whereas Ruud, after round one, bang, you know, straight back on it, taking the race wins, taking the podiums. So, though I'm not too sure about a walk 1-2, I am definitely going to agree with you that Ruud is likely to win the race. Of course, As our Factor Man says, those famous words. If you want to get in contact with us, then head on to Twitter and mention my Twitter handle, @KirkyLife, or indeed #GPVWCLive. We will try to get to you throughout the evening's events. So we've got 30 laps ahead of us. Just having a look at who is on any alternate strategy. Roy Vazile and Ballant Hammer both on the Prime Compound tyre. So Fox Racing going to be trying something different. Of course, Ballant Hammer starting at the back with that 10-place grid penalty. Oh, no, Ballant Hammer now on options, sorry. That's weird. Maybe he did qualify in options. Who knows? And anyway, Roy Vazile then, the only man in the field. He's now gone to garage. And he's back out on the primes. There we are. Okay, so Roy Vazile, the only alternate strategy man there on the primes. Everyone else starting on options. And let's head off now with the field. It's Risto Kappe for the second time this year on pole position ahead of his teammate. It's a walk 1-2. Ruud Heesterbeek, currently P2. Behind him, the ever-impressive in qualifying and in race now, Emmanuel Grischel starts P3. The question is, can he have a good start? Jonathan Holmes starts P4. With Pedro Milim, the lone Simcraft here tonight, starting P7. Philip Cullen starts P8 for Racing Aces PB. And the top 10 is rounded out by the two Wouters Automotive cars of Sandeep Chowda filling in for David Junt and David Franchich. Debutant Rachel Lekas, or Tulekas, sorry, for Twitch Enterprise GP starts P11 with Lewis McGlade. A nice, impressive, consistent run from him so far, starting P12 for Racing Aces PB. ST in the points. Will this be the case by the end of the race? Bent Zupanek starting P13. For the English outfit, with Marcel Rauter, the German, starting behind them, P14 for Smile. Menno Klont, a disappointing P15 for Satellite Racing, with Dawe Tapper out of the points once again, P16 for Street Fighter. Dennis Shorten starts P17 for Smile Power, with Christoph Schur, the lone Mazurek, P18 for the Dutch team. Matt Richards starts P19 for TSA Racing, and the top 20 is rounded out by Terence Grech, the top Malta Force driver for this round so far. Ben Schubert, who's been on a good point scoring form so far for TSA actually in recent races, a little bit out of position there perhaps in P21, with Roy Vazile, aforementioned the lone man on the prime tyre here, P22 for Fox. Jason Muscat, a little bit injured with the surgery he's recently had, he's P23 for Malta Force. Mark Fuller starts P24 for ST. What's happened there?
Supernex's gone off the track. He was weaving down straight and spun it. It looks like he might
be
okay though.
Okay. Yeah, no, there's another question. Oh! That's one of the Fox Racing cars. I think it's Vazile and Muscat getting into all sorts of trouble. Ballant Hammer rounding out the field. Well, that is drama on the formation lap already. And I really shouldn't put the commentator's curse on Benz already.
It's oh, wow, yeah. There's often debate about whether it's worth warming the tyres up on the formation lap, and some drivers do, some drivers don't, and it's usually the drivers that do that end up losing it, and we've seen that down the straight with two of them today.
Oh dear. We have a 5-car short field today. Maybe the gloves are off. I see McGlade there pointing inwards. I don't really see many other people pointing inwards. Everyone starting in a nice straight line. No one around the corner. As we look to the lights now, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And here for the first time at Silverstone, we're racing. And Gashella with a decent start there in the midfield. I think, Holmes has bogged down. The two walk racing cars flying away. Look at Melim there. My word, from P7. Up to P4, a great start from the Portuguese driver. Sven de Vries up into 5th as well. Holmes the main loser there. And McNaughton as well from 5th down to 7th as everyone tries to filter their way through the arena section. We had a couple of crashes here in the Formula Challenge. Everyone, though, seemed to get away nicely. And actually, if anything, it seems like Gischella has been one of the better drivers to get a start there. Still in P3 as we head down into Luffield. There we are. Brooklands and Luffield. I'll get these corner names right one time or another. As Capit, look at how close they are. Capit, Heesterbeek, and Gischella in very close proximity to each other. Milim's gone a little bit wide out of Luffield, though. Here comes Sven de Vries now. Will he have a look into Kops on lap one? That'll be a very brave move if he does. He is going to have a little look, isn't he? Jonathan Holmes falling in behind. And, he pulls back in at last minute. Milim holding on to fourth. It's been a great start for him so far. McGlade also said he was pointing out up to eighth already. And Zupanek, after that formation, that spin, up to 10th as well. So a great start from the Hungarian and the Englishman and indeed the Portuguese up in P4 as we head now onto the hangar straight. Lots of slipstreaming opportunity here. As we see all the cars streaming down, I don't see many people in too much trouble. Heading into Stowe now. Caput still holds on to lead. Easter Beak and Gashella in close Stowe as well. As there's De Vries up the inside and outside of Stowe now into the Vale. Milim holds on for now, though, as we end lap one, however. Risto Caput holds on to lead, but only narrowly from Easter Beak, Gashella, Milim, De Vries, Holmes, McNaughton, McGlade, Franchich and Zupanek.
Yeah, it was a good start by most people there. It's good to see that we didn't really have any major incidents. And Gashella finally got a good start as De Vries is looking up the inside of Melo. No, just slots himself back into fifth place. It really has broken up. Oh, here we go, De Vries now up the inside this time around. Oh, Melo's going to get the better drive out the corner though because it's a very tight left-hander. Really hard to go side by side through there. Melo holds onto the position. But look at De Vries now. He's got a much better run down the straight. Is he just going to sit on the gearbox? No, to the inside again. Up the inside. Can he get it done this time? He's going to run Melim out of room a little bit, just gives him enough room. They bang side to side, and De Vries is going to have the better drive now, surely, out of this right-hander.
Still very close.
Down. Yeah, he's got the power down, and he's just done it, but he's going to have to defend.
I think that was a good move from De Vries there, but here comes Melim off the inside of Kops. Very brave from the Portuguese man. And Sven running it right out to the edge, but not over the line. Good move from De Vries overall, as I see the two walk racing cars starting to pull away now from Gashella. Zupanek, by the way, has got past Franchich. He's up into ninth and onto the back of McGlade, who is caught up now in this battle. This De Vries-Milim battle has really constantined the field together. Got Holmes, McNaughton, McGlade and Zupanek all in there. As here goes Holmes on the inside of Milim. They're not going to do anything behind. Having a look to see whether any moves are being made. No, it seems like everyone is being sensible as the two walk cars continue. One and two not really troubling each other. I feel a lot of the race today is going to be decided by strategy. As we have a look at now, and De Vries pulling away from Milim, Holmes, McNaughton, McGlade and Zupanek. We're looking at Zupanek, he's looking hungry, and he might be looking at McGlade as easy prey into the arena.
Yeah, Zupanek is better than McGlade in Formula Champ, arguably, but you'd probably say that's right. And he goes up the inside, real late manoeuvre, completely misses the apex, and McGlade has run out of room. But he's still got the inside now for the second part of this arena section. They're going to go side by side as they come through this little left kink. It's really difficult to manage the car through there. And they're still going to be side by side as we go down the back straight into Brooklands. Who's
going to get... Franchich!
Wow!
Franchich on the inside there, he was completely unsighted. And he's had a little go. Zupanek passed McGlade fully. McGlade able to hold on there to P9. Oh, a bit of contact there with Franchich as well, though. The Wouters driver looking hungry there. And there's Choda as well, looking to get in on the act. McGlade looking under a bit of pressure here.
Yeah, he certainly is. He's going to hold the defensive inside line, and he will get the better right into the corner. But Franchich is going to try the switchback. He's right onto the back of McGlade now. It's really not the best place to go side by side. Franchich just pulls out, thinks about it, and he knows that he's got a nice long straight before Stowe where he can really try and challenge McGlade once again. Certainly McGlade had a good start, but he's struggling to hold his position now.
Behind them, there's a bit of battling up front. It's Holmes and Melim. Where are they going? They're going through Stowe. I think Holmes might have had a look at Melim. Melim holding P5. Also Menno Klont on the back of that P9 battle. So the Dutchman looking for some good points as well. As I'm just having a look, it seems like, yeah, the walk racing cars have flown away. Gashella and De Vries flown away as well. But now it's Holmes and Milim. And if there's anything to know about Holmes in recent races, he always seems to have trouble with the Simcraft cars at some point. And what we can hope for is a clean battle as Holmes dives up the inside. Bit late from the Englishman. Milim able to hold on up the inside of the other side of the arena now. Comes Holmes, and will he get a better exit? No, I think Milim's got him there. But very close racing from these two, all out on the wire.
Yeah, it's really close, and Holmes is going to try again up the inside, going into Brooklands. This is surely his best opportunity, but he's really being squeezed by Melim, isn't he? So Holmes is just going to try and squeeze him back, but Melim runs wide. Holmes is going to have to look for the switchback, and he doesn't quite have the power because Melim actually defended that corner pretty well. So Holmes is now going to go to the outside, but that's not the place where you want to go at this corner.
Oh, no.
No chance. Oh, and he's really running out of room as well. Oh, it's very, very tight. Almost,
look at Supernek behind! Look at Supernek there in P8! He's rolling to the back of McNaughton! I know that he ran slightly wide there at Cups, but maybe that is why! Oh, and McNaughton! Holmes was slow there, and oh, McNaughton! That's a real shame for the Englishman! Holmes and Mellon were slow through there, and that's going to lose the Englishman a whole host of positions! Where does he rejoin? Oh, that's down in P20. That's a real shame for Adrian there. Completely unsighted. And that's happened far too many times in World Sports Series and Formula Challenge so far.
Yeah, it's a real shame for McNaughton because he had to let off the throttle as Holmes was regaining his momentum after going a little bit wide trying to go around the outside of Mellon. And unfortunately, he let off. It didn't look like Zupanek really read the situation. There was a bit of contact and McNaughton's lost a lot of positions now. Let's hope he can at least fight back and get back into the points.
This battle for P8, by the way, has changed radically. So Francis is now past McGlade. McGlade in ninth, and here comes Menno Klontz in P10, Choda behind in P11, and McGlade's teammate Philip Cullen now to the back of this as well, as McGlade is slow out the arena. He is really struggling, isn't he? Klontz almost pushing McGlade around that corner. No love lost between these two, as Holmes is through on Melim into Brooklands there. I think Melim might be trying up the inside. You can't really go up the inside there, Pedro, though. He's having a go, isn't he? I think Holmes is going to get the better exit, though, and he should be ahead. Yep, there he is, as behind McGlade's being able to hold on to Klont, but Klont all over the back of the Englishman, trying every which way to get past him.
Yeah, Klont is now looking to the outside. Not going to happen here. McGlade is going to have poor run, though, coming out the corner, so that would give Klont an opportunity. And now they're going to go side by side into Maggots. Oh, but Klont just has to slot himself back in. Luckily, there's space. Yeah, there's space between himself and Choda. And Choda is definitely looking feisty as well. It's so weird seeing so many Formula Challenge guys right here, but they really are spicing up the racing today.
Oh my, Supernek up the inside of Melim as well. He is really on the charge, isn't he? As McGlade has finally been passed by Menno Klont, the Dutchman, up into P9, and maybe Choda's going to have a little look on the inside as well. Here comes Cullen as well up the inside of Choda. And oh, McGlade around the outside of Klont into the veil. Contact between the two. Here comes Cullen and Choda. Choda off the inside as well, a great battle. But if he just now Choda's past McGlade into P10. I don't know how it ended up in that order. McGlade on the outside of Choda through turn one. That's almost impossible. And McGlade loses two positions in the case of three corners. And here goes Cullen around the outside now. Maybe taps the rear McGlade. I'd be surprised if he got away with that with any terms of damage. And McGlade, unfortunately, falling back down the field now. Tapper and Richards right on the back of the Englishman, unfortunately.
Yeah, McGlade, I think ever the nice teammate that he is, probably let Cullen go through there, and Tapper just got caught out a little bit. As now Richards dive bombs up the inside of Tapper. Tapper's going to get the switch back though and retains the position. So opportunistic driving from Richards there, and it nearly cost him, but luckily he managed to save it. And there's no contact between the two going into Brooklyn. So Richards remains in 14th for TSA Racing, who also has his teammate Schubert behind him, who's actually been challenged by Jason Muscat. So Jason Muscat is about to go into 15th, up into the points. That's incredible from where he was in the back of the grid.
Oof, yeah, he's got close company though, hasn't he? He's got Ray Tulikis, who's had a poor start so far down in P17. And is that a Rauter or Jordan? I think it's, yeah, Marcel Rauter down in P18. So the German with a bad start as well. Up at the front though, back into P5. Bent Zupanek has now dispatched to Pedro Mellon. So we have an ST in sixth position. And he doesn't look like he's going to stop there. Holmes next on the radar for him.
Yeah, Mellon was definitely kind of the cork in the bottle for most drivers at the start there, because he had such a good start and was actually out of position by the time we got to turn one. But Holmes and Zupanek have got past him now. I'd be interested to see what kind of pace Zupanek has compared to Holmes, because they've never raced on the same track before, I don't think. So that'll be very interesting to see, as the big gap now between Holmes and De Vries, and you could just tell that really not being able to get past Mellon has, you know, perhaps cost Holmes, and definitely benefited De Vries and given De Vries a better chance of still getting on the podium here, because there's only 3 seconds covering the top four.
Oh, and Ruud Heesterbeek's past Capit. Don't know when that happened, but the switch has happened. Heesterbeek past Capit now, the gap a tenth, and maybe that is why Gashella is so close at only 1.5 seconds behind, and why De Vries is catching as well. Maybe the two went into battle and we didn't see it, but look at them, they're still close and they're still going at it, the two walk racing guys. Maybe it's time to have a little focus on our lead battle. There is 25 and 20 points at stake, of course, for Walk Racing. They'll be hoping to take all 45 home in race one.
Yeah, certainly. It looked like it happened on lap three. That was when the switch happened between these two drivers. So Cabot's been behind. He's for about four laps now, at least three and a half anyway. But he's certainly not let up, and he actually looks like, at the moment, he's probably the quicker of the two. So I don't know if there is any team orders or Cabot's having to hold station. Who knows in these situations. But if they can battle, that's going to be great, and I hope Cabot does have a chance.
As further down the field, Menno Klontner's just got past Sandeep Chowda into P9. This battle has changed dramatically, as I say. So Klontner up into P9, Chowda P10 there. Philip Cullen now the lead PB driver. Very close behind these three going into turn one. The Irishman will be looking for more points. McGlade P12, Richards up into P13, Tapper P14, Muscat P15. And there's a whole flurry of cars below him in P16. As Rude set the fastest lap on the last lap. So Rude used to be showing some good pace here in these early stages, only lap 8 of 30, I remind you, with maybe one or two stops in terms of strategy to go. Gashela staying within 1.5 seconds. I'm trying to find the next closest battle, to be honest. And I would say it's probably going to be this P9 battle between Klontner, Chowda and Cullen, all very close together. And just heading up to Copse now.
Yeah, let's have a look then. I was just watching the leaders as well, just keeping an eye on them, and yeah, Chowda's right up behind Klont, so of course, because Klont and Chowda and McGregor were all battling early.
What happened to Holmes? Oh, Holmes has spun! Let's have a look here. He was going into Maggots. His car just nosedived, and I'm surprised he hasn't lost a wing there, but Holmes, our second man to fall foul to the Maggots Beckett's complex. He's now down in P16.
That's and that weird. Means that,
yeah, it's like his nose just bottomed out or something.
Is it a Ben bug, Supernecker then? Is it
a bug? No. He's just got it loose, didn't he? So Ben Supernecker up into fifth, Melim sixth, Franchich seventh, Klont eighth, Chowda ninth, Cullen tenth. So this battle that we were looking at before, now even more juicy with extra points on the table.
Yeah, definitely more juicy, and Cabot is still all over the back of Heastwick for first position here. He's using all kinds of different lines going into the corners, so I really do think he's actually trying, but he's being as clean as he possibly can about it, because of course you don't want to take your teammate out in a situation like this. But I definitely would say these two at the front are battling for the win, and that's exactly what we want to see.
Yeah, absolutely. Great to see there's no team orders or love lost here. Perhaps it's worth having a look up at them now. Within 1/10 of each other. So it's not exactly like that. Here goes Cabot down the inside of Copse. And he goes a little wide. Surely he's to be to take the inside line now. And indeed he does. And he's able to stay ahead. Oh, wow. Just. These, I'd be putting in team orders at this point, to be very honest. I'd be like, just settle it down a bit, guys. Come on.
Yeah, I mean, what do you do though? Because it doesn't look like it. Either one is quicker than the other, because they both seem to be at about the same pace. They were in qualifying as well. So they need to try and pull away from Gegzela and Sven De Vries, who are both closing in, because the gap between the first and fourth position has now dropped to 2.3 seconds. So these guys are all concentrating together, which is good for us, but not good for Walk Racing. So they've got a real dilemma to really try and figure out right now.
As Chowda has passed Klont into P8 here, and Menno Klont signed to lose a lot of time here. I wonder whether he's had a bad couple of corners, because Philip Cullen, the Irishman, right on the back of the Dutchman now as we head through Abbey and up to the arena section. We've seen a couple of late dives into the arena so far. Cullen not opting to take that option. No, almost still steering himself into the back of Klont there. Lucky to keep it out of the rear wing of the Satellite Racing driver. But they're looking good for Wouters once again. P7 and P8 for their drivers.
Yeah, it certainly is. It's, they're always a team that seem to do better in the race than they do in qualifying. And they're up there. Chowda's got past Klont, of course. And Cullen and McGlade are just down the road as well for Racing Aces PB. Is good to see, and yeah, McLean's definitely seems to have picked back the pace up, which is good as well. So he's certainly performing here today, and it'll be great to see him get some more points in Super Cup as well, as he definitely seems to be settling into these cars now.
The gap up front has extended to 5/10, so the The hurry up was given to Rude there, evidently. He had his teammate go back past him for a little bit, but the Dutchman now right back on it. By the way, you're on lap 10 of 30 here, going on to lap 11. We are expecting the first pitters very imminently, actually. Even if you're, whether you're one-stopping or two-stopping, usually you're going to be in there now. Gischella, by the way, has actually closed on the lead as a whole to 1.2 seconds. So the Romanian starting to exercise his muscle here. De Vries closing in as well. So I wonder whether the tyre wear is affecting the walk racing cars a bit more now than it is the storm racing car. Because, I mean, Gischella looks to be cruising up to the back of them at this rate.
Yeah, it really does. I mean, what can you do when you're battling? You can't gain time on the guy behind you when you're battling unless you are just naturally faster by an incredible amount. So Gischella is definitely with a shout, as is De Vries as well, because De Vries is hanging on to this group, and this is going to make it really exciting to come the pit stops, because it's really going to make a difference about pit entry and pit exit here, and being able to get on and off the pit road, get the good final lap in before the pit stops as well. So this could really be crucial for the race in the next few laps.
Here indeed, we will keep an eye on these front guys as they head up to the pitting complex. It seems like the battle for P8 is still on, with Conte there in P9 close behind. Cullen's fallen away, as is McGlade. Richards 12th, Tapper 13th, Musgraven to the points in 14th, so a good recovery drive from the Maltese driver Marcel Rauter, coming rounding out the point scorers in P15, and thankfully for Adrian McNaughton, after his spin, still there in P16. So still with the chance of points maybe, as the two walk guys go round again, as do the front four. It seems like nobody's going to be pitting here on lap 11, from what I can see. Yeah, it looks like we're going to be seeing a couple more laps from everyone before we head into the pits, at least, as he's to be coming to defend off Cape here. Cape once again right on the back of the Dutchman. And they've got to be careful, though, because Gischella is still within striking distance.
Yeah, if one of them makes a mistake, or, you know, worse comes worse, both of them have a little tangle and a mistake, then Gischella and De Vries will be there to capitalise. There's now Cape right up behind his speed, but not quite close enough. Going around into Brooklands, of course. I nearly forgot. And, yeah, look at that.
I've got the track map with me, and I'm forgetting.
It's one of the easiest tracks to remember the names as well, and yeah, it's not going well today. But yeah, look at Caput, he's just, I can't tell whether he's holding back just a little bit through some of the corners, or whether the dirty air is really starting to affect him, because of course he's sat behind his speak for so long now. It's been about 9 laps that he's just sat behind his teammate, right in his gearbox, effectively. It's hardly been, you know, more than half a second behind his speak, and that's really going to be, you know, hurting him in more ways than it will be hurting his speak.
You do wonder what the pitting strategy is going to be here as well. Oh, we're going to find out. Cape it in.
Yeah, that's his strategy. He's going to go for the undercut. Yeah.
Let's have a look behind, see where everyone else pits. So here goes Bent Zupanek. Very impressive so far. P5, doesn't pit. Looks like the majority of the top 10 aren't pitting, in fact. Long way back, yeah. Seems like Cape is calling it on this one, and I do wonder how much traffic he's going to come back into. He's onto the prime tyre now. There's a couple who haven't pitted. I think Jordan's just pitting there, I notice. Where is Cape going to come out, though? Might come out in a lot of traffic here. Out of the pits he comes. He's going to be in the points.
Oh.
And oh, here comes Richards up the outside on the faster tyre as well. And that is not the place where you want to be coming out of the pits. Right behind another driver.
Yeah, he really needs to get out in front of Richards. And Richards isn't going to make it easy for him at all. And look at this gaggle of cars he's got behind him as well. And of course, Cape is now on the slower of the two tyres. So he may struggle even more. Considering, so this may not work out for Cape right now. This is not what he needed, and could potentially start to string out the lead battle a little bit.
So into the lead battle, Zupanek's under a lot of pressure from Milim, and he's off the road. Milim is passed. And, oh my goodness me, very close from these two. Malim with a great move, though. Zupinek off the road. Malim up into fourth. So actually, was Zupinek... No, Zupinek was battling with him, wasn't he? And here comes Francis as well. I think Zupinek's tyres might have just completely gone as Rudy Heesterbeek goes round again. Gischella and De Vries both go round again. But we look back to this battle now. Francis going on the outside of Zupinek. And Francis is round in a wonderful move as well. So Zupinek lost two positions there. And I think that was a little bit expected. Zupinek into the pits alongside Choda as well. And McGlay there going in as well in the background.
Yeah, no surprise for Zupinek. He's, I don't know if he had a mistake or something on the lap that caused that. Because I'm sure he was a bit further ahead than of Malim than he was when he got overtaken. So something definitely seemed to have happened. It'll be interesting to see his lap times. Have a look. Oh, he lost about a second in sector two, so it wasn't a huge mistake, but it did look like something definitely happened to him. And he's taken new tyres, so it'll be interesting to see where he comes back out now.
Cap it up into P8 now, by the way. But he must have lost a lot of time in that early stint, so who's left to pit? He's to beat Gischella and De Vries, both of whom are in very close proximity to each other. Pardon me, a bit of indigestion there. Then in P4. Francis P5, Klomp P6, and Cullen P7. Then we have our first pitter of Capit in P8. Rauter P9 hasn't pitted. Neither has McNaughton, Greg, Tulakas, or Shko. I keep getting his name wrong.
Your own driver as well.
Own driver as well. Great job. And we actually, let's go through your retirements as well. We've had two so far. Ballant Hammer and Jonathan Holmes deciding that enough was enough. I think it's good to see at least not too many as De Vries' pass at the outside of Stowe. Heesterbeek's in. And is this battle for pit lane entry? No, it isn't. De Vries goes round again. Gischella is in. De Vries will lead a lap, and I'm pretty sure he'll be happy to see the back of Gischella there. Now we see how much time Capit truly lost. Malim round again, which is very bizarre. The Simcross usually lose their tyres a lot quicker than this. Francic in. Klont goes round again. Cullen round again. And here comes Capit now. Rauter in. McNaughton in. I presume Grek and Tulakas will come round as well. As here goes Risto Capit now, round the final corner. Roosterbeek is... Roosterbeek? Lost my words today, haven't I? Heesterbeek is out. Here comes Capit, and he is miles behind, isn't he? Absolutely miles behind. So much time lost. And that couldn't have gone better for Heesterbeek. In fact, Gischella's ahead of Capit coming out the pits. So that's just how much time Capit has lost there.
Yeah, you know what else? De Vries is still out on track. And he's to set his personal best in the last lap. Actually, no, it wasn't. It was a lap before because he lost a bit of time battling Gigella there. But he's if he can just continue on for maybe one or two more laps, he'll surely gain the time on these quicker tyres because the tyres are still quick. And he could potentially leapfrog everyone and get a net first place by the time everyone pits. It's going to be a bit of a call. It's not going to be easy. Because he's about 3 seconds ahead of Gigella, so De Vries will probably have to find about 4 seconds in two laps. Okay, maybe that's not going to happen, but I think De Vries could definitely get second position here. That's not out of the question at all.
Let's keep an eye on him now. He's rounding Stowe. Surely he has to pit now, and indeed he does. Into the pits comes the American, Sven De Vries. Behind him is Malim, Klont, and Cullen. Klont and Cullen actually going into battle. Cullen around the outside, and that's a lovely move from the Irishman. Malim going round again. That Simcross tyre wear is pretty good now. Cullen and Klont in. Here comes Heesterbeek, and there's Gischella fighting away with Capit. He wants the second position. But let's see how much time De Vries has gained. He's out the pits now. On to the prime compound tyre. Here comes Heesterbeek. Is De Vries going to come out ahead of Heesterbeek here? I wonder. No, he isn't. Heesterbeek goes round. De Vries is out now, and De Vries has jumped both Gischella and Capit. You called it right. De Vries up into second. Gischella third. Net, of course, because Malim still has to pit. Capit has been shuffled off the podium.
Yeah, great effort by De Vries. And looking at his sector times, his tyres were definitely starting to go off. So he probably called it right. He probably wouldn't have got the benefit if he did another lap more. Maybe he couldn't do that anyway. But yeah, good effort by De Vries. He's always the wise old head. And he's got himself a net second place because Malim still leads. But he's going to pit. And that's surely going to bring him out in about fifth place once everyone cycles through. So Zupinek is still in sixth, which is absolutely fantastic news for ST Racing. We can finally say that their season has started in another, 15 laps time.
He has to make it to the end of those other 5th laps, so that's the big thing. As Choda and Klont are very close together there, look at this! Francic in 7th, Klont in 8th. Klont now in 8th, actually, just going around the outside of Kops casually. Oh, contact almost between the two! Close racing, Cullenbine in P10, won't be wanting to get involved in this. Francic, oh wow, Choda around the outside of Klont into Maggots. Great racing from these three. The battle for 7th, 8th and 9th really heating up as Pedro Melim finally pits. So Rudy Ismik will retake the lead of the race. De Vries still 2nd as Capit tries around the outside of Gashela. Still no cigar for the Estonians as they round the final corner. Keep an eye on where Melim comes out. It would be close to Zupanek only. But look at this battle. 7th, 8th, 9th and 10th all within a second. Great stuff between these four drivers.
Yeah, they've been together pretty much all race, have these guys here. Looks like McLeod's falling off the back of them now, and the racing just continues to hot up between them, even after the pit stops as well. So this is absolutely fantastic to see, and Jose, what's going on here? Is Supernex on option tyres?
He's going for the two-stop.
He is, isn't he? So that may or may not work out for him here, because what do you lose? You lose about 15, 16 seconds after you pit. I'll work it out. It's quite hard because you cut a lot of the track out here at Silverstone. So I only lost about 5 positions yesterday when I did my drive through because, you know, it literally took it no time out of me at all, which was good for me, at least anyway. So it'd be interesting to see where Zupanek would pop back out when he does make his second pit stop near the end of the race. He should, in all sense of purposes, go for as long as possible, maybe to about 80 or 85% race distance here before he pits again, to really get the benefit out of these faster tyres. He's gone, Cullen's gone off! Cullen's in the wall! Oh my days, that's a massive crash!
Let's have a look at that again. Riding up behind the three, and oh yeah, he just fishtailed it. It was a similar incident to Scott Beresford from yesterday in the Formula Challenge Race 1, except he didn't spear off into the other wall, he went straight in. His car is upside down, it's going again now, but he has been relegated right to the back of the field. The only man who hasn't overtaken him is Mark Fuller, though surely he will after the pit stop that Cullen is going to have to go through. That has promoted his teammate McLeod up into P10, as what's up to TC? He's the mix lost his front wing! Oh my goodness me, he's lost his front wing, where did he lose it? Oh, he spun! It was through Club! On the pit straight, he hit the pit wall. He's going to have to do an entire lap now without a front wing. Massive ramifications here in the championship for sure. De Vries now leads from Gashela. Capit third. Heestervik is in fourth, but he's going to lose that to Melim. Zupanek with a top five finish on the cards here. Choda will be sixth. Francic will be seventh. So Choda's actually overtaken Francic there. Klont will be eighth. McLeod will be ninth, and Tafel will be into the top ten as Francic has gone past through Choda once again. Looks like sensible team tactics from those two. They're not going to fight too much. But what a rookie mistake to make from Heestervik. I can't believe he spun there of all the places.
Yeah, I've literally never seen that before. I can't think of a time where someone else has done that apart from, you know, really just going out for it on a hot lap in qualifying, coming across the line. And look at that, Melim's going to go around the outside of him now. Zupanek the next one up. Yeah, so he's losing all this time. He's then got to have a pit stop. It's going to be a lengthy one as well. It's not going to be short. So he's surely going to come back out probably around this huge battle that's going on for about, you know, what is it, 11th on back to 18th. There's a huge long train of cars. It's going to be around there. Depending on how much more time he loses, here he goes now into the pit. So this is a huge for Heestervik. He needs to recover as many points as he can now.
I was saying that Zupanek was looking for a top five. He's actually looking for a top four, isn't he? In very close pursuit of Pedro Melim.
Well, he was ahead of him before the pit stops, wasn't he?
Well, Pedro just overtook him on the last few laps, didn't he? Oh, wow, late braking from Zupanek. Lucky to get it turned in there. But remember, Zupanek lost a lot of time on his final lap before he pitted. But of course, Zupanek actually's got to pit again, doesn't he?
Yeah, that's why he really does need to get this move done as quickly as he possibly can, because otherwise he's just going to lose out more and more. As Heestervik comes out of the pits now, and he does come out down in 20th.
Wow. But,
yeah, even further back than I thought. So
on the option tyres, though.
Yeah, he has got the tyres on, and everyone ahead of him, apart from Zupanek, of course, don't have those tyres on. Who's really battling away, and oh, he's nearly gone off the track, battling away with Melim, but the fight is still on, and Menin's going to go defensive, and Suplex, look at him! He thinks he's on the warm-up lap, he's weaving all
over
the place.
Oh, my word! No way! Whoa, that grip, though. Cutting across Milliam a bit too aggressively for my liking, personally. But that was a move around the outside. I know there's different compounds and everything, but you need some balls to get around the outside of Cops. You have to be committed. You've got to have full confidence in your car. And clearly that ST Racing car is working well for the Hungarian up into fourth now.
Yeah, he's looking really, really feisty here. I think he knows what he has to do. And he's got past Melim, tried to break the toe down straight towards Stowe. It didn't quite work, but, well, all this extra grip, he should surely pull away now. And he's got his work cut out because he's got to get back out. You know, I think he's probably, his best bet is probably 10th position, I reckon, at the end of this race. That's the best he can hope for. So we'll see what he can do. It's still going to be great for ST Racing. I'm sure he would have taken out before the start of today, wouldn't they? Any points of the board is going to be big for them now.
As Philip Cullen, unfortunately, becomes our third retirement of the day, the second man to be claimed, no, the fourth man or something to be claimed from the Magnus Beckett section so far today. It's a tricky track, Silverson. You need the perfect balance of aero, straight line speed and braking prowess to be able to navigate in. The likes of McNaughton, Holmes and Cullen have been claimed by it so far. De Vries leads by 1.1 seconds. Gashella very close behind. He's been able to lose Capit. So it's really all gone a bit pants down for Walk Racing once again. Not as bad as maybe people would expect, but I'm sure for their high standards, they would not be happy with this at all. Ben Supernek now past Milim. He needs to really open up the gap. He's gone wide again. I've seen him doing that a couple of times this race, and we've got a lovely new device in for this race, which actually tracks when you go off track. So it will like beep up. The DC will be able to see that. They can check it, and then they can much more easily give out cutting and extension of track limits penalties, which is lovely. We love when our DC gets a little bit of an easier job on their hands. So Benson's got to be a little bit careful towards the end of this race. Pedro P5 then, Francis P6 and Choda behind now in P7. He's about to lose out to Menno Klont once again. These two still at it after so many laps. And Klont down the inside of Stowe hasn't been able to get it done. Choda on the inside of Vale now. He's able to keep that P7, though always taking it pretty badly. Klont around the outside of the exit there. What a lovely move from Menno Klont, able to hold on. The Dutchman up into P7 now.
Yeah, great move by Klont, and he's working his way back up through the field once again. And a stellar drive from him. It'll be interesting to see what he can do. Joe is still looking over the back of him, and he goes up the inside. Surely not going to be on, and Klont just uses all the extra traction he can get around the outside of the corner and holds on to his position. And he's going to have to really go now because he's got Francic gotten about over a second up the field from him. So bit gapped out as this battle has become now, but Choda is still looking right behind Klont. Really, really close racing.
Behind these two, McGlade all on his own in P9. He'll be very happy with that. Dowie Tapper in P10. He's had a pretty good race so far. Tapper plus 6 Delta so far. Muscat even better so far. In the back of the grid, P11. McNaughton recovering in P12. Good to see him still in the points, actually. Matt Richards, P13. Router P14, and Rate Tulikis has actually come back into the points, P15. But there's Grekken behind him. Rude Heastwick now into P17 on the option tyres. I'm sure Rude will be aiming for that final point at a minimum. As the gap between first and second has come down yet again, we're actually almost going to cross the line to head on to lap 22 of 30 now. And I'm interested to see whether this has gone down any further. De Vries crosses the line now. Gashella. No, it stayed at 1.1, so I think maybe Gachet's got an advantage in some sectors. De Vries as well, and capping close pursuit as well, of course. It seems to me that everything has split out a little. Once again, there's not really many close battles on track. Of course, we've only got the 3 retirements so far, but that does mean that we're down to 22 drivers, so maybe everyone just settling into a rhythm now, hoping to get what they can from this race. Maybe actually the closest one is P10, Dowie Tapper versus Jason Muscat versus Adrian McNaughton, the one to look at.
Yeah, I think you're certainly right. I think Tapper's definitely going to have to do a bit defending here to try and hold on to a top 10 finish here today in race 1 at Silverstone. Because Muscat, who's come back from, well, I guess he made a mistake in qualifying. I guess he just exited to the pits. And of course, if you do that without returning to the pits, you cannot go back out. And I think that really affected him, as he really looks all over the back of Tapper now. Nothing's quite on yet. He can't dive bomb up the inside. He's much more wise than that, as he just runs a little bit wide to get better later apex and get on the power now. Right behind Tapper. What can he do here? He's got the slipstream. He's gaining, but now too far back still. He's just going to sit on the gearbox and literally push Tapper around the corner.
Love this. Up the inside of Maggots? Surely not. Oh, wow. Keep your nose clean, Jason. Looking around the outside of the Beckett's complex now. And look how much McNaughton has been able to close into these guys because of that. I found that I was doing this a couple of times yesterday in the racing as well. You have the guys ahead of you battling, and as long as you can even be off the throttle and close up so much as here goes Muscat around the outside of Stowe. Can he get it done? No, he can't. Tapper closing off the line really nicely, actually. And they're still able to hold on to P10, but it's only by the fingernails underneath his driving gloves. McNaughton in close pursuit as well. I think Tapper will be hoping beyond hope that McNaughton starts to make an impression on Muscat. And by the way, further movement up front, Choda's back past Klont from P7 and P8. That battle's still going on. But I think we'll say with this battle for P10 is pretty juicy at the moment and could end up in any order.
Yeah, it certainly could do. I think Muscat's looking at the most likely to pass, but probably also the most likely to lose it as well. As McNaughton, who, well, he's now out of position really after his early race unfortunate incident with Holmes and Supernek, has recovered his way through the field. He's got himself into 12th, and I think a top 10 would do quite well for him. It'd be rather fitting. But of course, Muscat has done well as well, and Tapper is just a good guy at defending. He knows how to defend. He's done it quite a lot because I remember last year he'd often qualify well and have to really defend for the entire race on the guys behind him. So it'll be interesting to see what he can do for the rest of the day. As Muscat's really the guy coming under pressure now, isn't he, from McNaughton through these fast complex of corners. Perhaps Muscat's just trying to regain himself and cool the tyres down a little bit before he goes onto another onslaught.
Heading down the hangar straight with these three now. Very, very close, and it's great racing. We love to see this. As around Stowe we go, no one really able to make too much of an impression as we head into the Vale now. Nobody going to be looking for a cheeky look either. McNaughton late on the brakes trying to scare maybe Jason off the road. Not much to be done. And running out of laps as well. Now on to lap 24 of 30 here at Silverstone. As, yeah, it looks like Muscat's getting a little bit under pressure from McNaughton. This is what Tapper will have wanted. And you can see there, Tapper's slightly starting to gap Muscat. He'll want McNaughton to keep up the good work and to potentially try and challenge for that P11. Of course, remember, in race 2, we have a reverse grid of 6 to 10. And so if the number 10 is called out for race 2, then we're going to have two very unhappy drivers in this battle, I imagine.
Yeah, I think you're certainly right, and I have a feeling as well that looking at where Supernek is now up the field, about 17 seconds higher up the field, I have a feeling that Supernek will come out in front of this 10th place battle, so this will remain the 10th place battle no matter what happens up front with Supernek. So this is really key now, really, really important, and just imagine Tapper and Paul. I'd love to see that. Always love to see Tapper doing well at the front. So let's see if he can hold on to it, but imagine the story of Muscat coming from the back to get pole for race 2 as well. That would also be something great to hear. And the battles behind haven't finished either, because I've been watching that Marcel Marcel Rauter has been battling with Matt Richards, got past him, and now they're being challenged by your new driver for this week. And he's to beat looming large right behind them as well.
Yeah, I think Rood has got this thing in his sights now. As Ben Supernek has pitted then. He has pitted for the second time. So we're going to see just how down the order he is. I think you are right. He's going to come out just ahead, if not in this 10th place.
Oh, he is!
He's been overtaken by all three cars. So it's still points for ST. Don't get us wrong. And Supernek is going to be on much better rubber now than these three, of course, but he's got to be careful, like really careful, otherwise he's going to find himself up the backside of someone. And look at this, already onto the back of McNaughton. McNaughton going defensive. Zubinek on the outside here. Will he be able to take someone around the outside? No, he's going to hold it off for a little bit, maybe to get the undercut. Oh, it's very close. McNaughton just about holding on, And now here goes Zubnik up the inside of Luffield. And that is a nice car move, although he hasn't got it done just yet. I think Adrian McNaughton going to be trying to hold on there. But I think Zupanek, oh wow, very good. Oh my words, I don't like Zupanek going all over the track like that. But McNaughton is holding up. That's a bit, oh, he's trying around the outside of Kops again, is Zupanek. And that supreme grip, not able to do anything though. He is really impatient to get past, isn't he? He wants his points back.
Yeah, he certainly does. And that's actually costing him a bit of time between himself and the guys in front, because Musket and Tapper have actually broken away from this battle. But here we go now. McNaughton doesn't want to give this up. He's going defensive up to Stowe. And Zupanek's going to go around the outside. Wow! And he's done it into the corner.
Unbelievable. What a great move from Zupanek. As I also notice here, look at this. He's to be up to 14th. So he's doing well as Tula kiss up the inside of Richards behind. That's very close between those two. Got to be careful. That's for the final point, by the way. So, I've just had news through that Tula Cass is actually driving with the full setup. He qualified on the wrong setup as well. So, impressive to be up there, even. I know how difficult it is to drive under the full setup myself.
That's incredible.
Yeah, I know. Unbelievable. So, fair play to him to be able to hold it there.
I think he should have taken a penalty and started from the pit lane. He would have done way better, definitely. I've seen the pace that he's got, definitely would have done better than that. So that's incredible. I can't wait to see what he can do in race two then.
Let's hope. Let's have a look in. De Vries has been able to hold on to that gap between Gashela and Capit. That said, Capit has closed a lot more onto Gashela, isn't he? So maybe a last lap battle for P2 here. Malim Orton is only in P4. He'll be very happy with this race game positions. As will Wouters. Once again, P5 and P6. They cannot be much more happier with that. Klomp P7, a good recovery drive from P15. McGlade P8 there. Tapper 9th. Still holding on to P9 there from Muscat. And Zupanek has gone ahead of McNaughton, but hasn't necessarily lost him, which surprises me. So I wonder whether these four are going to Constantine up again. Router P13. Rude Heesterbeek P14. And Ray Tulikas has actually got past Richards now to P15. This is for the last point, I remind you. Terence Greck there behind in P17. And they're fighting as if they're battling over the wind, these two, bless them. No reverse grids here as Matt Richards dives down the outside. He's not able to get past, though. Ray just about holding on. And I think we've already said it before, to get a point with a default setup will be mighty impressive. Richards around the outside, though. That's a bold move. Run out of room there by Tulikas. And, he's only got three more laps to do something, Richards. Three more laps for everyone else to do something as well, to be fair.
Yeah, Tulikas holds on to 15th with that default setup, and Richards has gone wide as well. So, yeah, I'm really rating Tulikas right here. Oh, I can't believe I said that.
Yeah? You're rating him, are you? Right.
I'm really rating.
We have a change. Meadow Clont and Choda are still at it.
Unbelievable.
Here goes Clont up the inside. Choda holding on for dear life as Heesterbeek is now past Marcel Router. Into P13 there. Menno Klont and Sandeep Choda, race-long battle it seems like, hasn't it? Choda just about able to hold on to that P6 yet again. But of course, to be fair, P6 is probably the best place you can be in at the end of race one if you're looking for a healthy boost for race two, because it's a reverse 6-10 grid. You're almost guaranteed a spot in P6, aren't you?
Yeah, you'll definitely improve your position. That's no doubt about it. So that is the golden opportunity spot to be in. As still this battle for 10th goes on though, because now Muscat's looking to the outside of Tapper, because it's battle for 9th now.
And oh, yeah.
Zupanek's right there as well.
Oh, almost contact between Zupanek and Muscat. And Zupanek's not happy either. Oh, he's diving up the inside of Muscat. Muscat gives him room. And it's getting a bit feisty down there, but Zupanek is up into 10th, and that could prove crucial if it is the number 10 which is called.
Yeah, it really is. That's the place to be right now, and he's got it. And now he's going to go after Tapper as well, because look at that, Tapper can't get away from these guys at all. So can he defend from Zupanek though? Because Zupanek's definitely the quickest guy in this pack. He's out of position on fresher tyres, so surely he's going to be the guy to make the move. He's just a little bit too far back at the moment, though, so he's just going to have to, be patient. Don't overdrive the car. Don't, brake later than you need to going into the corners. Just hold on to it, and he definitely can get the position as long as he just works away at it and doesn't do anything too rash.
Tapper with a really slidey exit out of left field there, up through Woodcut now and into Copse. We've seen Zupanek take all the people around the outside of Copse here. Will he attempt the same on Tapper? He's almost pushing him around the corner again, like you say. It's something that he's always done. Supreme grip around there, around the outside of Maggots. No, he's going to fall back in for a moment. But Tapper's position under constant threat. Here goes Zupanek on the inside of Maggots. No. Oh my god, you can't do that, Benz. I'm sorry. And he can't do it still. He might be under a little pressure here from Jason Musket here, perhaps on the back straight. Here comes Adrian McNaughton as well, trying up the inside into Stowe. Great battling from these guys. Been great battles and great excitement throughout the rest of it. And look, an extra spice has entered the mix. Here comes Rudy Speakers. Bent up the inside of Dowie Tapper. Late breaking. Good move from Bentz. Nice, calm, collected. He's up into P9, and Dowie Tapper can't find a way through. But there is Rude Heesterbeek in P13. He can see the top 10 in sights now, but he has only got two more laps to do it.
I actually can't believe that Heesterbeek's found this time. He's literally been 2 seconds per lap faster than these guys. That's incredible. He's looking up the inside of McNaughton, and nearly contact between the two. As this train of cars, I think now Tapper's probably going to have to defend this 10th spot. I don't think he's got a chance against Zupanek. I think Zupanek will pull away, although he's still right there. And there we go, he speaks now, looking to the outside of McNaughton. Can he make the move around the outside? No, he can't. He's going to try and get the switchback, but McNaughton just holds it in the middle of the track there. Very good driving from McNaughton. Held off Heesterbeek, and Heesterbeek knows that he needs to get a top 10 to have any chance of pole in race 2.
Surely he's got him here, though. He's surely not going to stick it up the inside of Copse, is he? He's a lot more smart than that is Rude. Tapper! Oh, he's off! Oh, Tapper, is he keeping out the wall? He did exactly the same thing as Cullen, but thankfully all wings are still intact for Dowie Tapper. And he is P14. Where is Rate 2 Lekis in? He's P15. He's closing up to him. So Tapper not out of the points, but that has promoted Jason Muscat to P10. And a very scary moment for Dowie Tapper there. Thankfully able to keep all wings intact. But that is 6 points lost. It's about 4 points lost for the Dutchman. Very unlucky.
Yeah, it's a real shame for Tapper, because I actually think he could have held on to 10th, at least from everyone, barring Heesterbeek.
He's coming 11th, he's past McNaughton.
He's coming, isn't he? He's really starting to come now.
Last lap, can he do it?
I think he can find the time in this lap, and it's going to be a passing to Stowe that he's going to have to go for. I think that's his one opportunity, so it'll be interesting to see what happens at the end of this lap.
I'm looking up to the leaders as well. They're just going through Copse. The gap between De Vries and Gashella is 1 second. Gashella under all sorts of pressure from Risto Kappe, or he was until Kappe went wide there at the Copse corner. I think it's worth looking up to these three now. I noticed that Chodra and Klont are still battling away, but these three are the podium guys, and they're still in very close proximity. Heading down the hangar straight now. We've really not had much to watch because there's been such wonderful action in the midfield today. But rounding Stowe now, he's not got many corners to do it. But I think he is looking back. Yeah, he won race one here last year, and he's going to do it again from P6. It's Sven De Vries with his second race win of the year. Third race win of the year, sorry, for Sven. Fabulous drive from the satellite driver. Manu Gashella holds on to second. Risto Kappe third, unable to convert from pole once again. Pedro Melim from P7 will be very happy with P4. I'm sure of that. Behind, David Francic will take P6 as the battle for P7 still raging on. Sandeep Chowdhury will come home to take P6. Klont P7. McGlade will come home to get a brilliant P8. Zupanek P9. ST are on the board with 7 points. LB over the moon with that. Muscat 10th. Heesterbeek 11th. Just missing out on reverse grid potential pole. Of course, it's 6 to 10 or a random generator. McNaughton 12th. Router 13th. Tapper P14. Rate 2 Lucas on debut with a point on default setup as well. Incredible job. Greg 16th, Richard 17th, Schubert 18th, Berzile 19th, and Dennis Jordan 20th, and Mark Fuller 21st. Your retirements from this race: Christoph Schur, Philip Cullen, Jonathan Holmes, and Balint Hammer.
Yep, and do you know what? Heesterbeek had a run at Muscat, went round the outside of him into Stowe. That's where I said it was going to happen. He went for it, And it looked like he might pull the move off, and Muscat just ran a bit wide coming out of Stowe, pushed Heastbeak over the rumble strip onto the grass and onto the runoff. And that was the end of Heastbeak's challenge. But a battle between the two anyway, and unfortunately Heastbeak missed out on a chance of a pole for race two. Muscat keeps himself within a chance, but imagine if we get Zupanek on pole. That would be something.
Yeah, absolutely. To remind you, our reverse grid potential candidates: Choda, Klont, McGlade, Zupanek, Muscat. So I think for Muscat as well, to come from the back of the grid to score 10th, that's an incredible effort. He has a chance to start on pole. That would be amazing.
Yeah, it certainly would be. That would certainly be something to see. And, I have to say, though, today, after the race, thinking about it now, I know Heastbeak had an issue and spun it out the lead when he wasn't under that much pressure, and that's cost him a win. But I'm surprised as well that Risto Capit has only come home in third place. It really looked like Capit could have been right up there for the win, and he was only just over a second away by the end, but I thought he would have got past Gexeller at least and potentially had a run at De Vries into the final laps, but it just hasn't happened. And unfortunately, Capit's going to have to continue to wait to get the win. Came so close here today. I thought this was going to be his best opportunity, but he's going to have to settle for another third position, which is a shame for him. But a great race nonetheless, and it's another win for Sven De Vries, and it really helps us in our title fight, doesn't it? It closes it back up once again.
Just a little. Well, actually, no, by 20 points, isn't it? 25 for first, and 11 for fifth. And yeah, what an uncharacteristic mistake from Heastbeak. That is a big talking point heading into race two. And yeah, it will be interesting to see who we get on reverse grid pole as well, because there's a real handful in there, isn't it? We've got Zupanek, who has won in Formula Challenge, but these are his first points in Supercup. And actually, let's get a good shout out for ST. Their first points on the board. They really needed to get second or a win to be able to even go above last place, but at least their points, there's something to shout about.
Yeah, they're not off the back, but they're going to be so pleased about that, to get points, and the performance that Zupanek put in as well. I don't know if he made a mistake doing a two-stopper, if that was the plan all along, but because he surely would have got at least a fifth position by the end of the race, but it's still a good effort by him, and really good to see, and it'll be interesting to see what he can do in race two now.
Absolutely. As we shall await. Who is on pole position for race two? Who would you say was your driver of the day from race one?
That's a hard one. It really is, because there were so many good performances. I really like Melim's start. Melim had such a good start, and yes, he did lose out to a few drivers and certainly held up a couple along the way, but yeah, it's a really good effort by Melim to get that position, but I'd probably have to give it to De Vries just because he drove a faultless race today, and I know we didn't see much of it.
He called a strategy as well, perfectly.
Yeah, he really did. It only got him up second, but it was crucial, and it really turned out to be the race-winning move at the end of the day.
Absolutely. I would have to agree with you. I think that the strategy was called flawlessly, as we actually have... Oh, hello. Have we had our reverse grid yet? Our reverse grid is six. Sandeep Chowda on pole. And so that means we actually have a Wouters 1-2?
No.
Is it Sandeep on pole? Are you sure?
But there was something about Francic being happy if it was six. Did something happen to Francic at the end of the race? Did he finish in fifth? I don't know what's happened here. I'm trying to read through the chat. And it's
you know what I can do? I can check live races. Because live races has the race recorded, of course.
Oh no! Looking at this, Francis said, "Meno, you will bang your head if there is a reverse six." Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's going to be it's going to be a Wouters Automotive front row. Andreas, hello at home. Hope you've got your new pair of pants on. So it's going to be Choda from Francis, Melim Capit, Gashela De Vries, the front three rows.
Okay.
But yeah. a real shame for Menno, because they were fighting all race, weren't they? So that's why he would be a little bit miffed by that, I would imagine, and he almost got him last corner as well.
Yeah, it was that close. It was just couldn't quite pull the maneuver off, and it's one of those things. You have to get the perfect corner to be able to overtake someone around here, and so that's a shame for Menno, but a great job for Walters, who go from strength to strength here today. As Tom Vandervoort enters the game, I can only assume, oh no, he's turned up in a Simcraft. What's Tom doing here?
The rule is, as far as I'm aware, of course, allegedly the rule is, there, nobody can sue me on that one now, four races in Super League, or the category above whatever one you're doing in the career ladder, then when you do a fifth, you're locked into that series. Vandervoort has done four races. So technically, he can take part in tonight. But if he takes part in the Midnight Car tomorrow, that's him done.
That's interesting. I wonder why he didn't turn up for race
for qualifying. Yeah. I don't understand why either. You would have thought that he would have been there, at least to get some stuff.
Yeah, get some points on the board for the team again. Of course, Mellon did a fantastic job of getting some good points, but I guess Tom might have been a bit busy today and perhaps couldn't make the first race anyway. But we're going back for the second race, so that's yet another driver that we're going to have signed from the back. And it's going to be great to see how he can come through the field in a slightly shorter race.
We've got Cullen there, we've got Holmes there. We'll be interesting to see what sorts of strategies we have as well, because we only had one person starting on the prime in race one. That was Roy Verzeil. It didn't really work out for him. Are we going to see a bit more variance of strategy? Because I think it's once again the call of the century, isn't it? Option, or prime all the way? Because it seemed to me that the primes lasted a lot better than I was expecting.
Yeah, what's the race distance?
17 laps.
Oh no, that's an easy one. Just go option. Option, full race distance. Easy call there. That's what I do.
You can't do option, full race distance.
Yes,
though.
You can. Yes, you can.
Yeah?
De Vries did half race distance on options,
so
I believe.
So he did 15.
Pretty
laps.
Certainly did.
Yeah, he did. He did 15 laps on the options.
A couple
race
more laps.
17.
But the tyres aren't going to, you know, explode and...
No, but you're going to lose a lot of time.
You're not going to lose that much, considering the amount of time you're going to gain in that time.
I'd just go,
yeah, definitely go option. Two laps on worn tyres in speech marks.
Maybe Sven's the only one who can do it, though. I mean, he pitted a lot later than other people, didn't he?
Well, Sven's going to win the race, then.
Maybe he is. We shall wait and see, Jonathan. We shall wait and see. I got the call last time in... Oh, no, it wasn't last time, wasn't it? But it was back in Turkey. That's when the option strategy worked very well. Apart from that, it's been all prime runners, pretty much, wasn't it?
Yeah. It's. I never thought I'd see option, but Kevin Siggy proved me wrong. Then left the series. So make what you will of that.
Oh, no. He left in Monaco. Let's be fair to him. He left the race after.
Monaco? Oh, yes, it was, isn't it? Yeah.
Monaco. We had that wonderful battle with Muska and everyone. Kevin was the only person who could get past him, and then he crashed.
Oh, yes, of course. Oh, right. Yes, he got past and stuck it in the wall and lost his front wing straight away. Well, Monaco can make anyone quit a series, so no surprises there. Especially if your name
right, then.
Is Lewis Hamilton.
Oh, relevant as well. Love it. So, looking at this grid. Choda, Frančić, Milim, Capit, Gašela, De Vries, Klont, McGlade, Zupanek, Muscat. Who do you have down for your winning race two, Mr. Jones?
Well, it's a hard one. Let's have a look. I kind of want to wait just a little bit just to make sure everyone's on the tyres that R Factor is telling us they're going to be on. Because at the moment it looks like we've got up two on primes, Walters on primes, Ben on primes as well.
A lot on primes, aren't there? Looking, there's some late ones, aren't there?
Yeah, I'm waiting for Melim.
Melim and Gašela. Melim on options. He has called it.
Melim's going to win. Melim's going to win and it here first.
McNaught, so you're saying Melim. McNaught on options as well. Richards on options. And Holmes on options. Interesting. Right, let's go through with this grid, shall we? Sandeep Chowda leads us off on pole position for Wouters Automotive. Like a walk 1-2 in race 1, it'll be a Wouters 1-2 in race 2. Frančić joins him on the front row. And behind them is, on option tyres, Pedro Menin. Now, Pedro made a wonderful start from P7 to head up to P4 in the first race by the first corner. I wonder what he can do with the tyre difference now. Risto Capit is P4 with the prime, and Emmanuel Gacela behind him is P5. We then have the two satellites of De Vries and Menno. Haven't seen them that close together this year, to be fair. Lewis McGlade starts P8. Ben Zupanek starts P9. And Jason Muscat starts P10. Ruud Heesterbeek starts P11 with Adrian McNaughton on the option tyres, P12. Wonder whether he's looking for a recovery drive. With Marcel Rauter starting P13. David Tapper is P14 with Rate Tulikis, hopefully with the right setup this time, P15. Terence Grech starts P16 with the two TSAs and Matt Richards on the option compound tyre and Sven Schubert on the prime compound tyre, P17 and P18. Over Zyl starts P19 and Dennis Jordan rounds out the top 20. And then rounding out our grid, we have Mark Fuller in 21st. Jonathan Holmes on the option tyre, P22. Balint Hammer, P23. And rounding out the grid in P24, Tom van der Voort on the prime compound tyre. Maybe he was late from work or something.
Yeah, interesting to see how far up the field he gets. There were only a few guys on options. Yeah, like you said, that's really quite interesting. I really thought that an option for 17 laps would work. I can't see the tyres going off that much in the last couple of laps.
But you haven't done the testing, have you, Mr. Jones?
Well, no, I never test them. I don't know what the word means.
You never know. Pedro might be able to blitz the field, options all the way, and you could be proven completely right.
He could do. He's going to have to get past the two guys in front of him first.
Yeah. Well, it's all about that. Start looking at him. Already angled in. He is ready to go. As our final two, Hammer and van der Voort fill out the back row. We look to the lights now, where we have 1, 2, 3. We are off and away. There's a massive lag. We're off and away. Okay, there we are now. Massive lag for me. Apologies. Wow. Yeah, Sam, you might have to commentate on this.
Yeah, I think I'll take over. So it looks like Chowda and Melim are battling into turn down here into Brooklands, and Melim's taken the lead, so that was key. Melim had to do that. Okay. He had to get past, and he's done it. He's got into the lead. Chowda's in second, and unfortunately, Frančić has really lost out there, gone down into fifth. And look at that, De Vries is already up into fourth, along with Capit. Those two, they're the guys that want to win this, and they've got the best chances. Capit now goes up into second position, but Chowda holds it around the outside. And that actually gives De Vries a chance going into Maggots now, because he's going to go nearly side by side with Melin. But Melin just holds in on, Capit just holds on for third place. De Vries down fourth, Frančić in fifth, Gaxelas in sixth, and Klont is holding station in seventh. But look at the lead that Melin's already got. He's already pulled away from the field, and Chowda is definitely having to hold everyone up. Capit looking up the inside again.
I think, am I able to be heard now?
Yep, I can hear you now.
Okay, good. Hopefully we're back in this. A lot of lag on my end. And there's a lot of battling up the front here, isn't there? My word. So Melim into the lead, and that was half expected. Chowda second. Capit third. De Vries fourth. Frančić fifth. Followed by Gacela, Klont, Heesterbeek, Tapper, and McGlade. That is a real gaggle of cars. I'm noticing who's the people in grief. Looks like Rater Tulikas, pretty much the only guy in grief there. So a shame for the guy who scored his first point in Super Cup last time out, but a good start here for Melim. 1.1 clear of the field behind Chowda, trying to keep everyone else at bay.
Yeah, it's really going to be hard for Chowda, because he's got some really good guys behind him, and Chowda's always It's like the brakes up there going into Brockton's, manages to recover it though into Loughfield and holds on, actually cap it, really coming under pressure a little bit from Sven de Vries right there. This is going to be a huge train of cars, and it'll be interesting because potentially this could be for the person who wins the race, depends on how Melling's tyres holds up. I think they will.
Cap it took cops horribly.
Yeah.
Sven de Vries was like, oh no, on the brakes we go. And that's given Choda a bit of a sigh of relief. The big factor we have to learn for this race is, does Milim have to pit? Because if he does, then we're looking for that magical 15 to 20 second slot in which he can come back into the race. Otherwise, he's very good so far, isn't he? Choda still second ahead of Capit, ahead of De Vries, ahead of Franchic, who's lost out a lot from the front row. But look at that, Gashello and Heesterbeek and Klont all not too far behind either. And there goes Heesterbeek up into sixth. Klont was looking for a bit of action as well, but Heesterbeek siding his way through the field nicely as well.
Oh, and someone's gone round at the back, and I think that was Sven Schubert. Yeah, just gone round with a huge gaggle of cars that are all stuck up behind Tapper at the moment, so that was a scary moment. Looks like everyone's got through cleaning though. That's it, we go back to the front, and I think Choda's still holding on somehow.
There's the front, and then there's Choda.
Yeah, okay, so Choda's the second front,
effectively. And here goes Capit. Capit doesn't want that to be any longer, does he? Straight up the inside of Brooklands he goes, and Capit is up into P2. Very close from all of these guys. Well, I think that move that he did to be made from Risto, I think he could be in with a chance of this reverse grid win now if he's able to hold on.
Yeah, certainly. And whilst Walters and Walk Racing cars were battling each other, their teammates are battling as well. Heesterbeek went up the back of Franchic, went wide into Brooklands. Luckily, he saved it though and managed to hold off Gixella through Loughfield as well. So, lucky escape for Heesterbeek right there, still in sixth place at the moment.
Yeah, indeed. And looking to go up further, as there we can see Risto Capit trying to keep Choda behind. The gap now 3 seconds to Melim at this point. Capit certainly hasn't lost Choda at this early stage of the race, as we head down into the Vale for the third time of asking out of 17. Capit seems to have a nice hold on it now. As to be fair, I think it's all about damage limitation now for Choda. He's got a very fast car behind him in Sven de Vries, though I think he's got a bit of a cap on his teammate Franchish. There's Heesterbeek and Gashella and Klont behind. Richards has made a good start. He's up into P9, but he's also on the options. He is very likely to pit at some point during this race. McGlade P10, Zupanek P11. Holmes up to P12 from the back. He's made a great start. Holmes ahead of Muscat, actually, who is down to P13. Tapper P14. And Vandervoort as well with an equally good start. Up to 15th for the Simcraft driver. Could be on for some points despite coming from the back of the grid. Already had two retirements, though, in the form of Ballant Hammer and Terence Grech, unfortunately.
Yeah, I don't know what happened there. That was quite far down the field, as Frantic is really holding up the guys behind him right now. So it's actually allowed second to fourth to break away, which is...
I think Bruce Heesterbeek's going to say, nope, I'm coming past now. Up into Cops who goes. Surely he's got the corner. And indeed he does. Oh, no, he doesn't. Like Capit, he seems to just slow down massively there on exit. And I wouldn't be surprised if he got some rear diffuser damage from that contact. Gashella trying up the inside. Here comes Klont as well. All Constantinering up now because of the slow speed that Heesterbeek came out of that corner. But nevertheless, he is up into fifth.
Yeah, look at this now. Matt Richards is coming onto this battle as well. As Klont is right up behind Gachella. Is he going to look up the inside into Stowe? No, he doesn't actually. He just stays where he is. And of course, yeah, Richards is coming and he's on the option compound tyres. So he's going to be hassling all of these guys anytime soon. As Klont now goes up the inside of Gachella into the final part of the lap. And Gachella's going to have to stay on the inside here because Klont's around the outside and he's done it.
He's done it, and that was within track limits as well. It was very close, but he's got him. Great move from Klont up into P7. Gashella there, P8. And as you say, here comes Matt Richards now on the alternative strategy, remember. P9, he's going to want to try and slice past these guys as quickly as possible. Then Bent Zupanek has gone past McGlade there into P10 and P11. Of course, these guys have got another option runner. Jonathan Holmes now getting onto the back of this battle. Muscat 13th. Tapper P14 and still holding off his compatriot Tom Vandervoort in P15. As we look up to the top once again, Sven de Vries has passed Sandeep Choda around the outside of Brooklands. Now the American can focus on trying to catch up to Caput. The gap to the top is only 3.3 seconds. So unless Pedro Melim can get past... Well, unless Pedro Melim is actually going to the end of this race on the option tyres, I fear that his race lead is not looking too good at all.
Yeah, just in that last lap alone, he was only 0.2 of a second quicker than Risto Caput behind him. So yeah, he's still quicker, but not by much, and that's really surprising to see, actually. So it is going to be a case of when do the tyres start to drop off of Melim, and I don't think he's going to have the kind of tyre wear that maybe, you know, Sven de Vries would have. So it's going to be a struggle for him, but you never know, maybe he's nursing them a bit, maybe he knows that he needs to hold on to these tyres, and it could benefit him towards the end of the race. That's what makes it so exciting.
Yep, I agree, as Matt Richards is now past Emmanuel Geschela, and he's slow on X out of the veil. Geschela giving him a bit of his nose up the rear wing, but Richards trying to make this strategy work. He's up into P8 now.
Yeah, you know, I'm just going to say something, moves like that, well, not the move by Matt Richards, but hitting the back of a car, you know, when we go to R-Factor 2, which is going to be inevitability, that is not going to last well for cars. Yeah, I've seen it a lot in R-Factor 2. You hit someone from behind, and you'll not only damage yourself quite severely, but you will spin at least one of you off, potentially both of you, and that's something that these guys are going to have to get out of their system once we make the move. As Gitcher is actually looking back up the inside of Matt Richards now, and can't quite get it done. So Matt Richards, getting all kind of wiggly on the rumble strips right there. And he's going to have to go now because he's got to use his tyres while they're still good.
I would agree. Looking back up to the front, actually, I've noticed that very much like race one, Schroeder does not like being let go, doesn't he? He's holding onto the back of De Vries here. But behind, Easterbeek is starting to pull away from Franchich. Then we have Klont in P7, of course, Richards and Geschela. P8, Zupanek P10. Now being hassled by Jonathan Holmes, trying to slice through on the option. Tyres, McGlade P12, Muscat P13. Vandervoort's now past Tapper for P14 and P15. But the whole field spread is actually still very close. Apart from Mark Fuller, who's now 59 seconds off the lead, the entire 21-car field is separated by 20 seconds. That is very impressive.
Yeah, that's incredible, actually. I don't know how you can actually fit all the cars in that kind of space. That's really good. Jonathan Holmes has actually moved into the top 10 now, so good from him after starting from the very back of the field. Let's see if he can actually keep it out of the wall this time, as Matt Richards is starting to get himself into a scrap as well, because Menno Klont is right ahead of him, but Getchener's right behind him as well. And the times are really starting to equalise between the prime compound and the option compound runners now as well, so it's getting more and more difficult for them to carve their way through the field.
Yeah, indeed. And I'll tell you what else is very difficult is Pedro Melim's plight in trying to gain more advantage on the guys behind him. He's still only 3.7 seconds away from Risto Caput, and we are coming up to the halfway point in this race. You'd imagine that those who are wanting to pit will be pitting very soon, though, to be fair, they might be wanting to go a little bit longer into their first stint so they can try and gain as much advantage as possible.
Yeah, that's certainly the case. As now Matt Richards right onto Klont. They're going to go side by side into Maggots. Who's going to yield? Richards just has to yield there. Good, wise driving, because that was only going to end up with one car going off into the grass.
When here comes Holmes now on the back of this as well. All of a sudden, it's become a four-way fight, and we got two cars side by side. It's Noah's Ark down into Stowe. Richards gets ahead of Klont. Klont gets ahead of Geschela, and Holmes trying all the way around the outside of Geschela as well, with such a wide line as well. Can't believe that worked. It did, though. So Jonathan Holmes up into P9. Matt Richards up into P7. And Klont's a little bit slow out of the veil there as well. I wonder whether he's going to bow down to Holmes' superior tyre grip here into turn one. Nope, he's able to hold on for now. As Richards tries to pull away, will Holmes look around the outside of the arena? No, he can't really. He's got to filter back in. He's going to try on the outside now of Menno Klont. But it's an interesting strategy, this, isn't there now? We've got the option runners all, and Klont with a bit of a light up out of the arena. And surely Holmes is going to have a little look down into Brooklands. But yeah, what sort of mindset would you be in? Is Geschela's looking down the inside of Holmes now as well? Holmes on the inside here of a sandwich that he doesn't want to be in, but he's going to stay ahead just about. Great work from Holmes to stay out of trouble there. Gashella with a very opportunistic move. It could have worked, mind you. And now those two prime runners are going to go into battle as Holmes scurries away in eighth.
Yeah, Holmes certainly would have had his heart in his mouth right there because he's had nightmares about clashes between himself and Gashella. So he's got through that one unscathed at the moment. And him and Richards have been released. So what can they do now? Can they carve their way through and catch up with the top six? It's certainly not out of the question. They can see them on the straight.
Look at Zupanek here in P11. Sorry, going back to the prime runners. Zupanek looking down the inside of Menno Klont here to find his way in the top 10. Now to the outside of Stowe. Klont covers him off, though. These prime battles are going right up, aren't they? McGlade as well behind with Muscat. Epic racing here at the Silverstone Circuit.
Oh, yeah, and there's contact between Zupanek and Klont going into the final corner as well. Luckily, they both got through, which is good to see. But yeah, I think most of the better racing that we had in race one was when everyone switched onto the primes. It seems to be a much more exciting tyre to watch people battle away.
And the fact that you've thrown in a couple of option compound tyres in there, as I've noticed. Oh, look at this, the two Wouters Automotive, sorry, Choda's fallen behind Heesterbeek as well now, so Heesterbeek coming to fourth, and Choda under all sorts of pressure from his teammate Frentzsch now for P5 and P6. This isn't about team scoring anymore, this is about pride, and Frentzsch is going to take those points, thank you very much, straight through into P5, Choda down to P6.
Yep, that's a good move between the two of them. That's probably the way they should run because Frentzsch is a little bit quicker as he was in race one, but Cho's not that much slower, so that battle could rage on for the rest of the race. Now Richards, instead of catching up with the two in front, is actually coming under pressure from Holmes as well, so we could see a switch between these two option compound runners coming up.
I remember then my voice might have sounded like a girl last year when it came to Matt Richards, tried a very audacious move around the outside of Beckett's, didn't work. It'll be interesting to see how the two option runners actually filter through. Of course, we're on lap 9 of 17 here now, so if someone's going to go to the end on these option tyres, that'll be incredible, but we're expecting the option pitters in any time soon. Pedro Millen still going round, by the way, and I think the crucial thing is to have a look at when the tyres start to drop off, when the times start to drop off for these option runners. That's when we might be expecting a pit stop to come.
Yeah, let's have a look. Pedro Millen still running similar lap times to what he's been doing, 36 sevens. It seems to be his kind of lap time, but Caput's getting quicker and quicker as he gets more and more used to these tyres, and the fuel's obviously going out the car as well. So you'd have to say Caput's certainly starting to reel Millen back in.
Yeah, I'd agree. As it looks like Holmes has got a very nice run on Richards here, down into Brooklands we go, and that's one of the easier moves that Holmes will have made during this race. And so, Richards, you know, the same thing that you're saying there again, heading up the back of another car. You're not going to want to do that in our Factor 2. But Holmes has made that stick, though. Richards has been able to get quite a decent exit out of Luffield there through Woodcut. It's going to be through Copse that we see any move, and Richards having to stay behind there. So a nice move from Holmes. And to be fair, Richards has got to watch out now. The prime running Emmanuel Gashella is right on his back as well.
Yeah, definitely. So Gashella's actually probably looking quicker than both of these two at the moment, isn't he? And it's definitely starting to show that the tyres aren't really being able to hang on for some of these option compound drivers. I think definitely the guys further back, of course, have had to use so much to get through the field and use some quite odd lines as Klont and Zupanek are going side by side.
Oh, and Holmes is in. Holmes is in. He's called that. Richard stays out. But yeah, as you say, Zupanek and Klont going into battle here. And Zupanek around the outside of the veil on the inside of Club here. Still going side by side. And Zupanek has got that. He is up into P9 now with Holmes fitting.
Yeah, I think it could be difficult to come back from that now. Having to pit and take tyres. It's going to drop Holmes out the top 15 at least. Looks like he could actually come out stone dead last apart from Mark Fuller, and actually that's exactly what happens. So definitely not going to recover to where he was.
Never know, Primus might go off as well. We'll have to wait and see. We will have to wait and see. Is Klont and Zupanek still going? Klont's had a very eventful afternoon, hasn't he? Very eventful. He has been unable to do he's been able to escape any sort of battle, and Zupanek has been yet to pull away from him at any sort of rate of knots. But surely with Holmes pitting, that might be a good indication to see when the likes of Malim, Richards and McNaughton might pit as well.
Yeah, which I'm sure most of them will all be in, apart from Malim. Perhaps he might take a risk and take a gamble. As you know, when you got a win on the line, you got to go for whatever you can get. And yeah, just to talk about Clunt, it's definitely, he's going to be exhausted by the end of today from all this driving. And I would say that that's something I like about Clunt, is that if you watch him, he might get overtaken, but he doesn't get flustered. He'll just keep it cool, keep it calm, and he'll work him with what he's got. And generally, he can stick with the guy in front of him, unless that guy is just naturally way faster. And that's good to see from Clunt, and that's what keeps him into some good positions at the end of the day. He's definitely a good race driver.
As Melim still goes round. But we've heard from our lovely Mr. Cameraman Mike Phyllis that Melim has also lost 0.6 seconds on that lap. So surely we are going to be expecting him in soon. It's lap 12 of 17 here at Silverstone.
Yeah, he's Melim's just can't. He's doing about the same lap times. He did drop off a couple of tenths that lap, but Capit is just getting quicker and quicker, finding more pace, and that's really helping him out. But you know, is he going to have the grip and the outright pace to overtake Melim once he catches up to him? That's going to be the question. And how long is it going to take from now? It's under 2 seconds, but what, we've got 6 laps left to go. Am I reading this right?
Was it five and a half, pretty much.
Not long left.
Not long left at all. It makes you wonder whether some of the option runners are going to try and stick it out to the end, perhaps. It would be a risky strategy for sure.
I think if they're out there now, they're probably not going to pit at all. I think both Melim and Richards, we're going to see them continue on. And McNaughton as well, who's down in 13th position. Holmes really hasn't made up any ground since pitting, so it hasn't really worked out for him at all.
Melim going round again. We look to Richards now. Is Richards going to pit in? No, he's going to stay there. But oh, look at this behind. Clont and Zupanek still battling around for P9, and Clont is passed again. Great battle going on for the bottom of the top 10.
Yeah, he gets back through, but Zupanek's right on his gearbox once again. And what can he do into turn one? He's thinking about, he's pushing Clont. He's literally pushing him down the straight.
That's actually illegal, if I'm correct, in single-seaters.
That's so unnerving, to be pushed into a corner.
Oh, wow!
Takes a dive bomb. Luckily pulls out of it at the last second.
Worrying. Very worrying. We've actually heard now, look how much time Malim is losing now to Capit. 1.7 seconds a gap. This might not... Well, he's tried, Pedro. And he's done a great job as Zupanek now pass and pushing Clont off the track. He lets him back through, thankfully. Good to see that. But yeah, losing time hand over fist is Melim. As yeah, Holmes sets the fastest laps on the new tyres, actually.
Yeah, he does. What's he done? Oh, I can't see his times. That's
he's done a 1:36.1.
Oh, that's only 0.1 seconds quicker than Capit, though, who's done a 1:36.2, which was the fastest lap of the race. Till Holmes has done that time. So Capit is definitely on a charge. He's getting quicker and quicker, 10th by 10th, and Melim's just not finding any more speed. He's a sitting duck now, I feel. I don't think he's going to be able to do anything here.
It's exciting times as we head on to lap 14 of 17. I think everyone's going to try and hold on now on the option tyre, if they can. The gap is 1.7 still between Melim and Capit. It's pretty much a straight battle between these two behind. Send De Vries and Easterbeek. Try and fight for the podium. De Vries doing a great job so far in P3 behind Wouters Automotive. 5 and 6 once again. A really strong event for them. Gashella P7 now past Richards on the options. When will they fall away? Clont P9. McGlade P10. So Zupanek is in P13. What happened to him? Let's have a look here. He must have gotten into contact or with someone. It was a little way back.
It was in the middle sector.
Yeah. He had a spin in Beckett, actually. He just got way, basically through Chapel, too much on the power, spun round, down to P13.
Still in the points, though, which is good for him. And he's certainly got a chance of making a couple more up as well. He's got a big gaggle of cars battling away in front of him. As I think De Vries and Easterbeek are actually battling for third.
Yep. Very close stuff here. I think he's to be done it pretty much. Around the outside of Maggots, great move from the Netherlands driver.
That's important for the championship. That means that now he's to be will regain some of the points that he lost. Only a few, but a couple of points that he lost from race one. But De Vries is still there. Look at that. He's to be literally having to hug the white line like it's his best friend to defend his way from De Vries. He's going to try around the outside of Stowe. And oh, he's still there, you know. And he's actually going to get the inside now. It's his final complex of corners.
Leave the space. And oh, De Vries around the outside of the exit. Through club we go. De Vries around the outside. Still holding on. There's still side by side contact between the two. As we head on to lap 15 to 17. Around the outside of Abbey. Here goes De Vries. Oh, what a move. And they still are in contact. They're still side by side. Here goes, he's to be coming to the arena, but wow, De Vries, that was a move and a half to be able to hold on to P3.
Both drivers there were absolutely incredible to have that kind of battling side by side for such a long period of time. It's really great to see, and it's not over yet, because look, here comes Heespeek once again. De Vries is having to defend early into Brooklyn, so Heespeek's going to go around the outside this time, but no, he's just been crowded out really by De Vries, and has to hold on station in fourth position.
I'm looking through the field as well. Zupanek is now into 11th, McLean to 12th, so McNaughton has had a bit of a trouble in P13. I'm also looking up at the front here, as Root Heestbeek is now back past Van De Vries around the inside of Cosworth. De Vries able to hold on. Great battle. Just stay on those two, Mike. This is brilliant. But Pedro is now holding the gap to cap it, and I'm not quite sure how.
Yeah, he's just done a 36.5 and a 36.6, which those two laps are his best laps he's done all race. So he's been holding back. He's been holding back.
He's been saving the tyres.
Yeah, he has.
Clever.
Clever racing. He's got, two laps left to go now?
Clever girl. As Root Heestbeek around the outside of De Vries here at Stowe. Oh, contact between the two again. Getting very feisty. And you must wonder, did Holmes have to pit? Or was it his call to pit?
Well, look at Matt Richards. He's definitely lost pace compared to Gixella.
But he's still there in
P8.
Yeah,
he's held it in P8. So Holmes probably would have been in P8 himself. And he's really shot himself in the foot there. Because he's looking like he could get some points if he can get past this train in front of him. But
not many
it's not
going to
be
it.
Much. No, it's going to take an effort.
And also putting a lot of effort in is this battle between De Vries and Heestbeek still going on as we're onto the Wellington straight here with these two. And look at that, Sven De Vries going ultra defensive. Into Brooklands we go. Heestbeek will try around the outside. De Vries goes deep and Heestbeek's going to try and get up the inside there. Into Luffield now we go. De Vries holding the inside. Heestbeek's going to try and get some better traction around the outside there though. And he's got that traction. De Vries gives him the room. And up through Woodcote we go. De Vries is still ahead, but only just as I try and kill a moth here that's been annoying me all day. De Vries up the inside of Kops. Heestbeek around the outside. Still can't do it. De Vries with one of the best defending performances I have seen all year. Muscat was good, but here comes Heestbeek around the outside of Maggots. Not able to do anything. But yeah, on such a wide track, this is an incredible effort for De Vries to be able to hold the championship leader behind.
Yeah, it really is. He's just sitting there like a rock, isn't he? Just moving around to the point in the track that he needs to be. There we go. He goes up, holds the inside. So he's going to have to go around the outside. And look how wide he's gone. Yeah, that's not going to work. And Heestbeek lights up the rear tyres as well. So, you know what? Mayhem's going to start his final lap.
He is.
And look
on
at
the option tyres, it's 1.2 seconds. Those tyres must be hanging off for dear life.
Yeah, he did a poor last lap, a 37.2, lost 0.3 of a second. So, you know, this is where, by this point, De Vries had pitted, so we don't really, it's unknown territory now, isn't it, in these final two laps. So it'll be interesting to see if the tyres fall off anymore.
I think it's worth keeping an eye on this, isn't it? We'll see whether Malim can make it. 1 second the gap, and oh, he's struggling round Brooklands, isn't he? Really struggling. Well, Luffield would go now. Capit ever closing. Is he able to close enough over the course of this lap, though? Heading up towards Copse now. This is going to be the corner where it hurts the most, for sure. He's going to have to lose so much speed. And in fact, he does lose a lot there. Let's go into Maggots Beckett's now. He's going to lose a lot of time through here as well. Capit ever closing. Taking it nicely. closing. You can see it there as we head through Chapel now. It's gonna have to be a last corner move, isn't it? 4 tenths the gap now. Caffett's closing. He's closing more down the hanger straight into Stowey. Go. It is going to be a last move, isn't it, for the last corner of this Silverstone circuit. Cabin with a decent exit. He's going to have to throw over the inside. Malim goes ultra defensive. Cabin goes right outside. Oh my God. He's gone deep. Oh, he's lost it at the last, Malim. What a great drive that was for Pedro Malim. He takes his first ever Super Cup win. Risto Capit with a one. He had to try it, didn't he? He comes home P2, the Vries P3, Heesbeek P4, Franchitch P5, Gashella P6, Schoeder P7, Klomp P8, Matt Rich is able to hold on to P9, Muscat P10, McGlade P11, McNaughton P12, oh, Van der Voort at the last P13 ahead of Zupanek. Rauter finishes out the final point scores. Schubert 16th, Verzeil 17th, Tu Lacasse P18, Jordan P19, Tapper P20, Fuller 21, and Jonathan Holmes retiring. I think that must have been in contact with someone because he private messaged me and said, what a surprise. I'm presuming you got a little bit of contact there, along with Greck and Hammer. They're all out, but kudos where kudos is due. What a drive from Pedro Melim.
I don't know if the tyres did go off or if that was just nerves at the very end, because he must have been so nervous seeing Caffett just closing on him around that last lap, because the gap just dropped away and completely disappeared. But Melim held on. He took the right line into the final corner. He stuck it right on the left-hand side of the track, like he's driving in England, and didn't budge. And Caffett went for it, but he just went a bit too far, went wide onto the rumble strips, and once he'd done that, there's no coming back. And Caffett, good effort for trying, and a good result, but once again, I'm sorry to say, Caffett is still looking for his first win, but great job by Pedro Melim, absolutely fantastic, really pleased for him to get the win. I'm so pleased, going to have to give him my drive of the day before you say anything else. He just made the call that I wanted him to make by going on option compound tyres. I'm so glad that he did it, and it paid off for him. Good effort.
It worked, didn't it? I'd have to agree with you. Well, let's talk with the man who lost out there, Risto Capit. Ultimately, a good day in the office for you again, but so close yet so far, still unable to convert that pole into a win, and again, so close in race two, but Melim with a crazy strategy call, which ultimately worked.
Yeah, it really did. It's I just thought, as soon as you said it was 17 laps, I just thought option tyres are going to work. And okay, maybe they didn't quite work, but it worked for Melim, and it got him the result that he wanted. And I'm so pleased for him. I really am. De Vries, once again, just to point him out, closes the gap a little bit more to Heesbeek. And that was so crucial to get that third place in that epic battle that the two of them had. I know it's not going to make a huge difference in the championship, but it could be vital come the end of the season if De Vries can really pick up the pace in the final second half of this Super Cup season. So good effort by him as well for third. And anyone else down the field that I need to talk about? Matt Richards, another option compound driver, really good job. A ninth place, that's good for TSA. And Zupanek, another couple of points for SC Racing. It looked a bit scrappy along the way, but a couple more points for them. So good once again.
I was aiming the question at Risto, to be fair, since he is in here.
Oh, sorry, are we doing interviews?
We are, yeah. Yeah, sorry, Risto.
Sorry, Risto.
Yeah, just talk to us about your races, how they go.
Well, race one, I made some mistakes, so I let Root pass, and I could have gone past him, but I made more mistakes, and driving behind him, I got very bad air, so I had to pit one lap even earlier, so that was lap 12. Others could run the options 2 lap more, so I lost the time and had quite a higher downforce than Emmanuel. So we had a great race with Ruud as well, but I couldn't get past third. And race two, I was quite fast. I put less wing for race two, it was great. I was quite fast into P2. I saw that Pedro has options. I knew it was impossible. I mean, I had 12 laps in the race one, he did 17. I was even driving with like boost one for some time. Final laps, I thought, oh shit, and then I tried to catch him, and you saw maybe what happened. I break too late. He breaks so early. If I just break normally, I would have won, but no win for me, but good points. But I still didn't gain on Sven, so bad race.
Apologies for the swearing there, by the way, but looking forward to the Red Bull Ring. Do you feel that you can have an opportunity there to finally take that first win? Because you seem so close. You seem to be on the pace every time now. Near and near enough. And, of course, you're the second man this year to take two pole positions. So it's evident you got the speed. Do you just need luck on your side, perhaps?
Luck, not really. Just not make any mistakes. Everything here is a result of mistakes and miscalculations. I should have been more aware. And in the end, the second race, I thought I was going to run out of fuel, but I didn't. So I was saving there. And in race one, I just made some mistakes. The difference between me and Roots is the mistakes. Well, he crashed in race two, but by race one, but still, just need to be more consistent. And yeah, I'm sure I will win eventually, but I really want to catch Sven in the standings, but very hard.
You have that one over him at least. Well done on your results, Risto. And thank you for joining us as we now move on to our first race winner. Sven De Vries, you did this last year, but from a bit further forward on the grid, if I remember correctly. It was a wonderful, wonderful strategy call from you, going later than everyone else on the options, pitting, coming out in the lead. Oh, no, not in the lead, but second. Then, of course, you had the luck of Rude crashing out. You inherited the lead. All just seemed to fall perfectly into place for you today, didn't it?
Yeah, it was about time I had the luck on my side. Qualifying, I spun a last corner on my fast lap, so, you know, qualified in P6, so figure, you know, here goes the bet luck again. Had a decent start, got stuck behind Pedro a little bit, and then once I got past, I think the four of us just drove our way, but the gap was the same throughout the entire first stint. Eventually, I noticed my tires were a little better than Gaxella and Rude, so I figured, I think it was lap 14 or so, I knew I was reaching the cliff. I figured I'll do the opposite of what Gaxella does, try and get the get the move on him done that way. So I went to the pit. I started doing my last lap on the options. I knew the tires were going off, but I also knew that they may have been in traffic or battling with each other or cold prime tires. So I got ahead of them. Then, luckily for me, Root spun off. So it's too bad for him. It's good for me. It gives me an opportunity to close in the gap in the championship. And then race two was it was incredible. That was probably one of my most intense fights I've ever had.
We saw that. It was great.
I think we both showed there why we are battling for the championship. It was awesome.
Next up is Red Bull Ring. And looking back here, you took the win in race two, one of your many race wins from last time out. Of course, this time we're running a new build. We're actually running the Red Bull Ring instead of the A1 Ring. Have you had a chance to go around it, and what challenges are you expecting there in 2 weeks' time?
I've not practiced yet. I do recall from last year, I spun around in race one, which put me in P10 and gave me the lead or the reverse grip pull. But I remember I certainly was not the fastest around there, so we'll have to do some work and try and see if we can get a good setup there. And if not, it will be another damage control race. But we'll see. We, you know, good hopes, and at least today was a good run. So,
well done on your results, either way. And we'll see you next time as we now move on to Frido. Frido, it's Pedro Milim, your first race win in Super Cup on a strategy which I gave no hope to. How tight was it by the end? Because surely your tyres must have been screaming by then.
They were a bit in the end. I had 11% in the end. It was quite hard to manage them in the end, but I had practice, and I knew it was possible. I just need to keep it going, keep it smooth, and it should go to the end, and it did, and I'm very happy with it.
As you should be, and especially being the lone car for one race, at least you had Van der Voort coming in to help you in race two and scoring points as well, so a good shout out to Van der Voort there from the back. But where do Simcraft go from here? Because you won't have Van der Voort next time out. You're looking for a driver with podium potential, from what I hear, of course. Are you ready to adapt to whatever new teammate might come your way? Are you expecting to work harder for the team? And more importantly, are you expecting to lead the team from this point forward as well?
Well, it's a hard time for the team. It's of course Tom leaving to Super League is not ideal for us, but we'll manage it. I think the guys Alex and me are gonna fight it, and we're gonna find a nice driver. We'll need to adapt. Probably, I don't know. I don't know who's coming. Still unknown, but. We're gonna help each other. I think we, no matter who comes in, it's all about the team. We need to get good points to get to the front of the championship. If we want to win this year, I'm a bit far behind in the Drivers' Championship, so it's kind of hard for me. But we will see in the future. I think it's gonna be hard, but I like challenges, and it's gonna be one. But I think. We can manage it.
Well, it would certainly be nice to see you on the top step of the podium again sometime this year, Pedro. So thanks for joining us. And thanks to all our drivers for the interviews. It's been an epic, epic round once again for the Super Cup. And as Appa mentioned, next time up we're heading to the Red Bull Ring, which has been a lovely surprise in both real-life motorsport and indeed sim racing since its reintroduction last year. Some wonderful racing last year, and with the new build of the Red Bull Ring, I'm sure we're going to be seeing more of the same in 2 weeks' time. I would just like to take these last few moments to firstly thank our cameraman again, Mike Phyllis, and our co-commentator, Sam Jones, before I remind you of the rest of the racing going on in the next 2 weeks. On Thursday, that is tomorrow, of course, you have the British Grand Prix coming up, and then we're back onto the Independent Series. On Monday, we're heading to New Zealand for the New Zealand Touring Cup around Manfield Park. On the Tuesday, we have the Indy 500 Classic, it's the GPV WC Indy Classic, which is half the distance of last year's Classic because it was far too long for its own good. Should be good fun there. And then we've got the Austrian Sports Series on Wednesday, and then we start all over again with the single seaters in 2 weeks' time. Open Series and Formula Challenge on the Tuesday, and Super Cup on the Wednesday. And we're just going to have a little final word from Pedro, as he's told me he wants to tell me something.
Yeah, I just want to shout out to Tom Parker. He helped me a lot in this race, before the race and in the race, managing the tyres. He was key for the win, and thank you, mate. It was a pleasure to have you.
Well, there we are. A lovely shout out to end a lovely round. From all of us here, then, it is a very warm goodbye.